must also want to recognize two major skaters, Whiskey Ginger and Sunshine. USPS's Bench Book Fly, Emerald Isle, and Frack Attack. Ladies and gentlemen, the United States Olympic Service.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, please rise. Gentlemen, remove your headgear. Find the nearest red, white, and blue object. We have a number of them, including all of the USPS skaters. And for the performance of our national anthem tonight, please welcome performing singer-songwriter Marcus John Ochoa.
By the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the ramparts we hung were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that a flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free?
Ladies and gentlemen, Marcus John Ochoa. And now back to the tunes being sung by DJ Elisha. And we've got 30 minutes on the period clock.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the historic Fillmore Auditorium for tonight's Rocky Mountain Roller Girls doubleheader. Up to bat here in our first game and getting set up, we have the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls Red Riding Hoods versus the United States Pummeling Service. I am Miscommunication.
And I am Postal Cervix.
And the game is in play. We've got Phantom Menace on the line for USPS
versus Shred Her Wheats for the Hoods.
By submission.
Now, of course, if you've been following us all season, you know that we have playoffs between our own home teams and then also the home teams from Denver Roller Derby. We will have another game coming up later tonight. The Shotgun Bettys and the Sugar Kill Gang will be fighting for league dominance. Phantom Menace drawing first blood to the penalty box with a track cut. Shredder Wheats is lead jammer.
Phantom Menace got that track cut just as she passed the very last skater in the front. That's probably not her favorite way to start a game. Shredder Wheat is through on her first scoring pass. That's going to be 5 points for the Hoods.
For those of you who are new to roller derby, she picks up that fifth lap point for lapping the other jammer who is in the penalty box. Shredder Wheat slamming into the pack. Hoods looking to clear a way through the forest for her, and she's out on the outside. 5 more points for the Red Riding Hoods.
This triple shot, Misto trying to get a last minute hit in here. Phantom Menace just coming out of the penalty box. She is hitting the pack around the same time as Shredder Wheats.
Shredder Wheats up on her toe stops in the infield. She gets nudged the outside. Number 22 from Red Riding Hood clears the way. Shredder Wheat's out on another scoring pass for another 5 points. Phantom Menace still on her initial pass and now is out and ready to score.
Looks like the Hoods are trying to cause a little disruption in the back of the pack so that Shredder Wheat's can get through quickly. Getting a little business up there by Triple Shot Misto.
Shredder Wheat's allowing Phantom Menace into the pack. She does pick up 2 points. Shredder Wheat's picking up an additional 2 points, 15 power points on that last jam for the Red Riding Hoods.
That's not bad.
When the whistle blows for our next jam, it'll be number one.
Oh, it looks like USPS was able to pick up 2 points there at the end of that jam. And we are going to have Devastator jamming for the USPS.
And Tater's on the line up against number 147, Havoc. We've got a timeout being called. 28:07 frozen on the board. Probably just an adjustment to that score because we are in play. Havoc getting caged at the back of the pack by the United States Pummeling Service defense. And that leaves room for Tater to take lead jammer. Havoc actually becoming lead jammer. Tater, though, out and hot on her heels.
Yep, the
Devastator also out of the pack.
The pack was starting to race, but now it looks like they're slowing down, bracing for impact with the jammers. It's going to be 0 points for the USPS.
And 0 points as well for the Hoods. 2 points for Havoc and the Hoods. 0-4 USPS, 19-2 with Leslie Borden on the line in blue. She is up against number 617, Harper Bazaar.
There's some issues with the scoreboard they need to correct.
Well, it looks like the officials are discussing something. Apparently there's a correction that needs to be made somewhere.
A couple quick ones. We got Derbyville and we got 5 on 5 magazines. These folks help out RMRG and we hope you thank them.
Both teams circling up on the track pre-jam.
Yeah, several skaters that are skating tonight competed in the Bestrooms tournament last weekend. That was fantastic. If you tuned into Colorado Sports TV to watch,
that was a great weekend of roller derby. And of course, we are back on the track. Harper Bazaar up against Leslie Borden. USPS again wearing a navy blue with red stripes. We've got the Hoods in their traditional red and black.
Great defense here by both packs. Neither jammer is out yet. And I lied. USPS, the jammer, Leslie Borden.
Lead call of the game for the USPS.
Harper Bazaar, he had bounced around there at third one. Still trying to get through.
And Leslie Borden is on her scoring pass. She has one more skater to... Oh, and it looks like Leslie Borden is going to be going to the penalty box for a forearm penalty.
So Leslie Borden heads to the penalty box for 30 seconds. She will also lose her lead jammer status. That means we're going the remaining minute and 6 seconds in this jam. So we have Harper Bazaar out there, the only jammer of record, already picking up 5 more points for the Red Riding Hoods.
That also means that the Red Riding Hoods are on a power jam, as they have the only jammer out there.
We have 3-on-3 in the pack. Harper Bazaar coming up on another scoring pass. Looks like Leslie Borden just escaped the penalty box. She is back in play as well.
Harper Bazaar, though, picking up 10 power points and a total of 15 points right now on the board for the Red Riding Hoods. That penalty doing its damage against the United States Pummeling Service. Leslie out. She was sitting on points already, headed to the box. But she will pick up 5 points in that pass. Harper in the fray right now against Triple Shot Misto and Pixie Your Battles in the pack. She's caged at the back of the pack while Leslie up at the top with one to beat. Doesn't quite beat her by the end of the jam. But four additional points for USPS.
So at the end of that jam, We got 37.
Score now 37-11. 25 minutes left in this first half. We're going to have red Nama, number 30. Skating for the USPS. Sorry, that is Nama Stay Away. It's crazy skaters. She's up against number 44, Shredfer Wheats for the Hoods. Tonight is the last game that we will see the Cereal Sisters, Shredder Wheats and Honey Punches and Throats.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's awesome.
Yes. And out in front and lead jammer is Shredder Wheats. Four of the Red Riding Hoods. Nama Stay Away with one left to beat. Tara going for the hit, not getting it. Mistress Terrible. So USPS out and ready to score, but Shredder goes through the pack, picks up 4 points, and calls off the jam. Hoods right now with a lead of 41-11, but with a little less than 25 minutes left on the first period clock, it's anybody's cliche right now, Postal.
That is a beautiful statement right there, Missy.
Stepping to the line for the first time tonight for the Hoods, we've got She Who Cannot Be Named, number 88.
She's going to be going against number 22, Phantom Menace, who has already had a turn tonight. She was the starting jammer for this game. Took a little tripsy to the box, so I'm sure she's going to not be looking for a repeat of that jam.
Menace picking up lead jammer status, but she is forced to recycle at the back of the pack. Havoc looking for the track cut. Menace eaten by the pack. She Who out and ready to score, so Menace calls off the jam.
That was a quick call there by Menace.
Great job by the Red Riding Hood's defense. You know, if your jammer isn't going to be out first, you might as well knock her to the outfield while she's still close to the pack. Oftentimes I see skaters just let the jammer go when she gets declared lead. You don't have to do that. It's not a penalty. You don't have to not hit her. Not a penalty when you're lead jammer. So continue hitting her. Reabsorb her back into the pack and see what you can do.
It's even more satisfying to hit a lead jammer.
Major little Pain, number 726 on the line for the ladies in red.
We're going to have 138 Devastator skating for the USPS.
Major Little Pain out and a lead. Tater still caged in the pack. A little 1-2 punch by Harper Bazaar. Keeps her caged in the pack in her place, and Major Little Pain finding it on the outside. 5 points for the Red Riding Hood.
There's a little helmet cover stash there by Devastator at the end, but she decided she wasn't done yet. Put the cap back on, called off the jam.
Tater out ready to score, 0 points. For USPS, score now 46-11.
It has been three jams since the USPS has been able to throw up any points. However, when they have been getting lead jammer status, they've done a really good job of at least ensuring that the Hoods didn't get any points.
On line four, the Red Riding Hoods, we've got Honey Punches of Chokes up against number 1041, Leslie Borden. Honey looking for it on the outside, but we've got a tripod being built by the USPS defense. Mistress Terrible looking for the assist with her jammer and trailing in the back of the pack. Hopefully she doesn't get lost in the fray.
Leslie Borden is trying to get past a red tripod in the front.
Big hit there by Flipper at turn three.
She gets recycled to the back. This is really like quick rebuilding of walls by both teams.
Honey Bunches of Chokes up against Flipper up the top of the pack. Two other USPS blockers. They are doing their best not to let her go. We have gone a full 40 seconds now without lead jammer status.
That is not easy. Captain Crunch just laying the hits out. This is like the third time she has hit Leslie Borden and drawn her back.
The new rankings just came out, and RRG has moved.
Yeah, this does not happen. I think this is like, what, two laps around the track, and neither jammer can get out? That's crazy.
Triple shot Misto sending Honey Punches and Chokes all the way to the back of the line at Starbucks. And finally, Leslie Borden breaks free. Lead jammer, she's got 46 seconds to use that to her advantage. Honey Punches and Chokes still in the back of the pack. She takes off the helmet cover, looking for a little star stash action against the USPS. This may work for her, but up at the top of the pack, we've got Flipper. Had triple shot Misto in with the super fast waterfall, but it's not fast enough.
That was like a backwards 1 foot waterfall. That was beautiful.
That's one of those real skinny stream waterfalls that you see in Oregon a lot. Three points on the board for Leslie Borden as she calls it off. 46-14, USPS now signaling for a team timeout. Thank you so much for joining us here on ColoradoSports.tv. We've got live coverage tonight from the Fillmore Auditorium. We've got the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls home season continuing with the Red Riders up against the United States Pummeling Service.
All right, Misty, let's see if your notes match mine. What's lead jammer looking like for both teams right now?
We want to thank...
So the Red Riding Hoods right now holding lead jammer status, four of the seven jams. USPS holding it three times. However, I don't always count lead jammer status when there's a lead jammer that goes to the penalty box. So I count that as two of seven lead jammer status.
That's what I have, yeah.
Mainly, though, what we're seeing up on the board between the Red Riding Hoods and the U.S. Pummeling Service, all of those points, all power points.
Again, power points being so much cooler than just regular points.
I don't know about cooler.
Well, it's cooler when you're the one.
I don't think it's cool
when you're scoring
when
the power points.
Patukas is in the penalty box.
It's cool for the other team.
Yes, okay, cool for the other team. But who wants to be cool for the other team when you can be cool on your own
team? This is true. But then you can power block.
She who cannot be named, number 88 on the line for the Red Riding Hoods. But out in front, that's Phantom Menace, lead jammer. She who looking for it on the outside, one last blocker to beat. That's number 37, Bob Blah Blah.
Pummeling Service is kind of spread out, but they're still doing a really good job of kind of covering all those holes. Phantom Menace is through. She just threw up 5 points for the Pummeling Service.
She who picks up a back block penalty, she will head to the penalty box. I actually wonder if that's why USPS is kind of spread out in the pack. Hope the jammer, hoping to get some speed up, may slam into their back.
Ah.
You could maybe troll a back block off of that if I use my imagination. 10 points for Phantom Menace, 5 of those right now power points for her, as she who cannot be named is in the box with 57 seconds left in the jam.
I love how Phantom Menace uses her suave mohawk to get around those little edges. There she goes again. Look at that. That's amazing. So pretty.
Five further points. That's a 15-point power jam as she who cannot be named is back in the fray. But she who headed to the penalty box on her initial pass.
Yep.
So she still has to pass the pack one more time.
Four more points for the Pummeling Service. She who is back in play. I saw her bench coach jumping up and down a few minutes ago, so they mean business.
Big hits in the pack by Havoc. Ooh. And we've got Phantom Menace cleared all the way out to the outfield, and we have a misconduct penalty being assessed to number 99, Make You Pay.
That was like bowling or shuffleboard or something, skater shuffleboard.
I am guessing that the flavor of misconduct assessed to Make You Pay was hitting a down skater.
Might have also been hitting, I think she had already started calling it off. So she had kind
of
relaxed a little bit.
There's a list of misconduct penalties that you can get assessed to you.
It's like ice cream flavors.
We've got an official review being called. Where's my timekeeper so I know whose it is?
Those of you that watch Besters, there are actually two official reviews that were actually retained at Besters, which it's like seeing two unicorns in one weekend. It's crazy.
46-40, USPS tightening up that score. 18 minutes and 39 seconds frozen on that clock. Huge jam for Phantom Menace. That was a 26-point jam, catching USPS up. Like I said, folks, about 6 minutes ago, anybody's cliche tonight.
Yes.
I drove right past them on my way here.
That last jam was almost like one of those movies where, like, you know, the heroes of the story that are behind, like, come up, and only we have two heroes, so it's just going
to
keep going back and forth.
Next to
it's like a movie with no bad guy.
Judging by the captains who are in the center, this official review actually belonging to the United States Pummeling Service. In roller derby, each team is granted one official review per period. If the officials agree with the team, they get to retain it one more time. If they do not, if they have it overturned, though, then they do lose it. Now, a recent clarification to the rules does sort of allow that official review to be used for any dang reason whatsoever. So you'll often see if a team has not used their official review by the end of the period, them using it to come out and just verify that the stripes are white on black.
So yeah, it's like black on white. Yeah. That girl's shorts are distracting. Their helmet cover's too shiny. I mean, again, you know, use it or lose it, so.
Harper Bazaar lined up for the Red Riding Hoods against a Devastator 138 for USPS.
Devastator assuming a circa 2007 toe stop on the jammer line post. And we have a lovely little two wall in front, bridging four wall in back formation.
Tater looking for it on the outside. She's only got two blockers to beat from the hood. She does it easily. Lead jammer. U.S. Pummeling Service.
It's a lot easier to get lead jammer when the other team only has two friends.
Your lead jammer.
Harper Bazaar looking for assistance from her blockers. Her blockers way at the back of the pack. We've got a whistle being blown. And we are going to have three blockers in the penalty box, two standing, one seated. 4 points for Tater. She falls off the jam before Harper has a chance to get to the pack. 46-44, two-point game. But the big story we're going to see right now is a Salt and Peppa, the only blocker out there for the Red Riding Hood.
Salt and Peppa had communicating a little bit with Shredder Wheat's like, don't worry, I've got a plan. It's going to be okay.
You know when a Salt and Peppa has a plan? It's going to happen, though.
Yes, that's true.
Peppa puts her mind to it, and she will do it. She's got a big grin on her face right now as the jam is in play. Number 88, she who cannot be named. That is not she who. Number one of the Red Riding Hoods back in. We've got a three now. Shredder Wheat's, though. What am I doing? What am I talking about? I don't even know.
There might have been some helmet cover. Nope, yep, that's Shredder Wheat's.
That's Shredder Wheat's.
I think there was a stash there, so you were looking for the helmet cover, and it did not at that time exist.
Shredder Wheat's out of the pack with a fast 5 points.
I am not seeing. Ah, I see. Namaste Away was doing a little helmet cover stash, but she just wound up in the penalty box, so this is going to be a power jam for number 44, Shredder Wheat's. It's so confusing with the whole helmet cover stash, because you count on that star. 5 more points for the Hoods.
Mostly announcers just like to complain about how confusing things
yes.
are. If we could just have it mansplained to us more often.
That would be great. I would like the refs to have giant foam fingers and for all of the skaters' names to be in neon on the back of their jerseys. That would make me happy.
Shredder up at the top of the pack, trying to look for the out of play, but the pack is very much so not 20 feet out. We get an out of play call on Marv Hertz. She's going to call off the jam with another 5 points. 10 power points for the Red Riding Hoods. They pull ahead 66-44. It's a total of 15 for Shredder Wheat's.
Namaste Away was so low, I couldn't even see her. She was trying to grab a few points there before the end.
20-0 in that last jam, score 66-44, 16 minutes left in the first half of the first game of a doubleheader here at the Fillmore Auditorium.
Numbers. Phantom Menace was trying to toe-stop her way up the outside line. However, she was hit out by Shihu. Had to get recycled to the back. But now she's running up the inside. She is out, but, she is lead jammer.
Yeah, that was a little miscommunication in the pack by the jam refs. Honey Bunch of the Chokes at the back of the pack. And Phantom the Menace with something more fancy than the movie she was named after. 5 points for the USPS.
I would love to see her just do an entire lap only skating sideways. That would make me really happy. Nice hit there by Assault and Pep. A Phantom Menace thought she had it easy on the inside, but there was a little surprise waiting for her.
Ghetto Kitty has to let her go, and that is Cinco de Rinco, as my friend Joe Mama would call it. 5 points. Right now, Honey Bunches of Chokes taking the star off of her helmet. You will see her shiny, shiny red helmet there in the center of the pack. She's stashing that star, hoping to sneak by or perhaps pass it off, but pivot. Shihu, though, coming into the pack from the penalty box right now.
Phantom Menace is just starting to get real greedy with these points. She just wants all of the points all of the time. That was another huge jam there for Phantom Menace. We went from 44 points to 64 points. 20-point jam.
2 points separating these two teams. USPS at 64, Red Riding Hood at 66. 14 minutes left in the first half.
Versus Havoc, the next time the whistle blows.
This is the best kind of game.
This is Blue Shelley's first time with the star tonight.
Blue Shelley with the star for the first time tonight, up against Havoc for the Hoods. Shelly looking for it up the middle. Mistress Terrible losing it a little bit there in the wall, and that allows Mendes, or Shelly, to sneak by. Lead Jammer USPS. Havoc out though and ready to score.
Havoc trying to get fast enough and close enough that she can hopefully force her to call off the jam before any points. Let's see. And it looks like we got 3 points for the pummeling service and
4 points. Havoc and the Red Riding Hoods go tripping through the forest and steal
That's
4 points.
Even if
you're
not lead jammer, you never want to dial it in, because if you can do what Havoc did, you can turn the tide.
Are you taking notes on everything that you're saying so you can practice what you preach, Postal?
Yes. Totally. Skating sideways, I have big letters on my hand.
Hood's feeling Major Lil Pain up against Devastator, and Major Lil Pain becomes lead up.
She is going to the box for a forearm. So Devastator's going to be lead jammer. That was interesting, because I thought she had already been called lead, but hey, I'm sure Devastator's not complaining.
Sometimes I like to hear whistles in my head.
Yeah.
Tater already thick in the fray on her first scoring pass, though the Hoods shutting it down right now.
That is just a beautiful rotation chip of red there.
Big nudge to the infield by Motorbutt.
Now we got a two-wall in the back, and just in case she gets past that one, we got another two-wall waiting for her in the front.
Great penalty kill by the Hoods. No actual points on the board with Tater coming back in. Tater already sitting on 4 points. Headed into the penalty box, and the USPS takes a 1-point lead. We have our first lead change of the game, ladies and gentlemen. 71-70, 11 minutes left in the first half.
Nice. And that is
Shihu on the line up against Pixie Your Battles for the first time in this first half.
Pixie Your Battles, it's coasting around on the outside on one foot.
Pixie
becomes lead jammer, reabsorbed into the pack. I.e., you're not out of the woods yet, as she is out and ready to score. USPS yelling and screaming and hopping.
Pixie calls it off, no points.
That was a null jam, which is what she wanted.
Emerald Isle jumping up and down, screaming for the call off. She is joined by Frack Attack on the bench. Frack Attack recently getting her master's degree about a month ago. Yes. She is super fancy.
No wonder there have been so many smart calls from the bench.
Yes, I would like my master's degree in derby.
Yes.
Lou Shelley on the line against Havoc. Havoc fighting up to the top of the pack. The USPS defense, though, there to say hello.
The pack is almost at, oh, it looks like Blue Shelly is going to be going to the penalty box for a form.
Or penalty call.
Oh.
And a track cut being called on Havoc. We're going to swap those jammers out. Oh, Blue Shelly forgetting where the penalty box is. So she will go ahead and do another lap. So Blue Shelly going to not have the advantage in this penalty race.
Wow.
Missed the penalty box or first.
This is a very obscure page in the WFTDA rules book right here.
Well, there is that point of no return, and it's kind of a loud orange.
Yes.
And that's louder than the Phantom of the Opera.
It kind of is loud, yes, definitely. Yes. If they both would have gotten there at the same time, that is a very obscure paragraph of the WFTDA rule book, one that I don't entirely remember right now.
Havoc out and ready to score. Blue Shelly exiting the penalty box and still on her initial scoring pass. We've got 45 seconds left in the jam. Havoc fighting against Bob Loblaw. Love Hurts setting up that brace. And that's at number 30. Namaste Away also in the pack.
Oh, Havoc almost got out. Then Bob Loblaw just got in this last-minute surprise hit, knocking her all the way to the back. These blockers are on top of their game right now. Every time you could see that look of relief on a jammer's face and they start to go forward, they just get taken out.
Both defenses knocking the jammers out of bounds. Blue Shelly with the star in her hand. And the Red Riding Hoods are not fooled by that big bad wolf.
That was nice.
You're welcome. Havoc out of the pack. She picks up 5 points for the natural conclusion of the jam. Blue Shelly, though, not completing her initial pass. So we have another lead change, folks. Hoods taking the lead, 75-71. There are some cookies to put in your basket, Postal.
Yes. And we are going to have the top scorer so far for the USPS, number 22, Phantom Menace, who is just not satisfied with anything less than like 19-20 points per jam. So we'll see if we get another lead change out of this one. She's having a great first half.
She's on the line against Harper Bazaar, but Menace getting past Motorbutt. The jammer. Bazaar out and ready to go. Pack, though, racing away. The Hoods looking to control the pack speed. She who up at the front with that pivot stripe.
USPS again trying to at least get one person to slow down, cause a little bit of disruption.
Well, you know, the USPS always trying to cause things to slow down.
That's right.
I was just at that other one today. I prefer this one.
I was at the post office today. It was pleasant, actually.
75-72, Hoods on top by 3 points. We've got Devastator on the line against Shredder Wheats.
Shredder Wheats versus Devastator.
Jammers definitely earning their volunteer salaries. I guess it's negative salary since they pay dues. But definitely earning those stars this weekend. It has not been easy. Both of these packs are on fire. They must have had their kale salads and coconut water this morning. USPS lead jammer.
Tater out, but Shredder Wheats crunching behind her. Forces the call off. We're not going to have a score change, just a clock change. 6 minutes and 34 seconds remaining in the first half.
Wow.
If you are in the Denver metro area, still plenty of derby to be played and plenty of great seats here in the house at the Fillmore Auditorium. Get you down here. By the time you find parking, it should be about the end of halftime.
Yeah. Beautiful venue.
Titan I Am in blue with the Sparkle United States flag on her leg. She is up against She Who Cannot Be Named.
Titan is out. She is lead jammer.
This is Titan I Am's first jam in this game. She Who with the stash star, Triple Shot Misto and Bob Loblaw, though, not having it. Don't forget, folks, they raised the price on getting past the USPS this week.
Yes, it's not forever anymore. Titan is through. 5 points for the crumbling service.
5 points for Titan I Am, and that, folks, is going to be 77-75 lead change for the crumbling service.
See, with those leggings, she has the power of America behind her. So,
power of America.
Power of America.
Per America.
Yep.
I think you just say per America.
These
per America? Per America.
These colors skate.
These color skates.
These color skates.
With that star still stashed up against Triple Shot Misto. But they're going to have to let Titan IM go. Five more points. Triple Shot Misto going to head to the penalty box for a clockwise block.
Misto got direction of gameplay.
Titan IM slamming into the pack. She decides to call off the jam. We've got a forearm penalty being called on he who cannot be named, who would pass the star to have it.
85-75.
USPS pulls out in front, 10 points, 85-75, 4 minutes left in the half.
We're going to have Phantom Menace up again, USPS.
She will be skating against Crucial Taunt. Taunt's first jam of the game.
Phantom Menace sneaks around the outside. She is going to be lead jammer.
Taunt forced to remember that love hurts on the inside.
Oh, it does.
Crucial Taunt out and ready to score. And Menace with a back-blocking penalty. Menace was on her scoring pass. She was the jammer. We are going to go the remaining minute and 30 seconds left in the jam.
It's the hard thing about being a jammer. You want to be explosive and go for those holes, but if a blocker happens to step in front of you at just the right moment, back block city.
5 points on the board for Crucial Taunt. We've got a minute 15 left in this marathon jam. Crucial Taunt slamming in a triple shot Misto, but Peppa, like, just opening the door for Taunt. The Taunt, betwixt love hurts. Peppa looking for a way to assist her and has to focus her concentration on Phantom Menace back in. We've got an empty penalty box right now, folks.
It's crazy. Hoods are doing a fantastic job of, like, providing offense for, like, a second and then immediately switching back to defense.
3 points for Phantom Menace. Apparently she picked up a few points on people who are out of play, so those points don't count. We've got Taunt still on a scoring pass and a forearm penalty being assessed to USPS blocker. Menace picking up 5 points, and we've got 22 seconds ticking down in this jam.
Crouton fights her way through, and that's 5 points on the board for the Hoods.
Crouton with another 5 points on the board for the Hoods. Phantom Menace, though, out in front. She's got one more to beat.
Oh,
that's Major Lil Payne.
That's a low block. Major little low block.
A major low block only because it's major low pain.
Yes.
4 points apiece, though. See that low block coming in useful, purchasing some time for Crouton to get back into the pack. We have a score now of 97-89. 14 points for the Red Riding Hoods, 12 points for the USPS in that last jam.
Crazy madness, man.
2 minutes to go.
Tater on the line.
Arthur Bizarre and Devastator are your jammers.
On the line, Tater on the line for the USPS. Harper Bizarre on the line for the ladies in red.
Tater was almost out. She got hit to the inside and is going to recycle back where Harper Bizarre is. Oh, but it looks like Tater picked up a forearm penalty. It has just been forearms left and right tonight.
Tater to the box, but we're going to call the jam. We unfortunately have a skater down.
We are calling the jam. We've got a skater down on the track, whistle blown due to injury. You'll notice the skater's taking a knee and also kind of setting up a wall of defense around their injured skater. It's like it's a USPS skater.
For those of you that are new to Derby, anytime a skater does obtain an injury, if all goes well and she is able to return to the game, she will have to sit for 3 jams before she is able to return to play, just to make sure she has enough time to get her bearings back and recover.
Now, just to be clear, her bearings did not fall all over the track.
Not her skate bearings. That's a good point, Missy. I didn't think about that.
That's all right. That would be terrible. I point out inadvertent puns. That would actually take a good amount of effort.
That really would, yes. This is a great time to thank our EMTs.
We do rely on our EMTs. Of course, we can't have a game without them.
Yes.
And I like to say they don't drink so that we can stay safe.
Yes.
Score right now, 89-97. Clock frozen at a minute 33. Trying to get a view there, and I'm not quite getting it. That last jam, we saw 14 points put up by the Red Riding Hoods, and Phantom Menace, even though she gave up 30 seconds to the penalty box for a back block, putting up 12 points of her own for the United States Pummeling Service.
And it's also interesting to point out is we're only a minute 30 from the end of this half, and we've only had 20 jams. We've had a lot of really amazing defense. The jammers have not been able to get through, well, either it's been amazing defense because either one jammer has been getting through and her team has been doing amazing defense, or, you know, we had one jam where I don't think either jammer got out.
If you are just joining us, we were frozen there for a bit of an injury break. We will send that blocker off to her bench. I'm still trying to get a number for you folks at home.
We don't recognize them without their helmets on.
So we're going to find out. Apologies to our fans. That was Leslie Borden, actually. So Leslie will sit out for the next three jams. If you're watching from home and concerned, do not worry. At halftime, if I don't see her back by halftime, I'm just going to go check. And if you are at home and concerned, I'll make sure that I get an update for you. So don't worry, Miss C is on it.
We'll keep you posted.
While we're getting rolling here, let me thank
Shredder Weeds putting on the star for the ladies in red.
Official partners of the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls. Remember to check out the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls on Facebook.
89.97 USPS on top. USPS, though, lagging behind due to a couple of power jams they gave up earlier in the first half.
Yes.
So now we see kind of the scores flipped. I'm sure we will see that score flip again and again in that revolving door that is the scoreboard.
Yeah, we've seen some really impressive defense in the game. There's been some amazing penalty kills by teams whose jammer was in the box. They were able to really shut down the other jammer and stop the bleeding a little bit. We've had, again, jams where neither jammer was able to get out. So the defense has been in fuego.
Shredder Weeds in this power start with Devastator still caged in the penalty box, and she is seated. So more than 10 seconds left on her penalty. Shredder Weeds looking for it on the outside. A swing and a miss. Oh, a swing and a successful hit. She will be forced to recycle. Major LoPain being sent back in. Clears the way against Triple Shot Misto and will head out on a forearm penalty as Shredder Weeds becomes lead jammer.
Make You Pay, number 99 in red, has been doing some fantastic offense there for her jammer. She's been going to one line or the other and trying to squish the wall a little bit.
Tater back in, already preemptively stashing the star as Shredder Weeds gets knocked to the outfield. No power points on that jam. She just now picks up 5 points. Love Hurts being sent to the penalty box, and that star being handed off to Triple Shot Misto. She is out and ready to score for USPS. Shredder Weeds, though, on the outside, keeping that energy going all morning. 4 more points for Shredder. 3 points for Misto, though. She steals it back. Score 9-3 in that last jam. We've got 26 seconds ticking down on the clock.
Some nice last-minute offense there by Havoc. The Hoods have been doing some fantastic offense for their jammers in this half.
She Who on the line in red up against Blue Shelly. We're going to have an official timeout. I believe what we're doing is we're resetting the clock.
Uh-huh. Well, we have a one-point game. One more jam in this half.
10-3 in that last jam. 99-100 USPS on top. She looking for a block against Blue Shelly, but she's stuck in the fray behind Bob Loblaw and Flipper.
Folks, don't forget, just because the game clock says zero, We're gonna see
nice hit there by Honey Bunches of Chokes. Shihu out and lead. I bet she's gonna go for a lead change heading into the half. Mushelli out and ready to score. USPS lining up at the top of the pack. But Shihu cannot be named. Doesn't rely on weather to get through on the inside. She calls off the jam, picks up 4 points. And we are going to have
another
the fourth lead change of the game headed into the half. 102-100 United States Pummeling Service. 15 minutes on that halftime clock. Thank you so much for tuning in to ColoradoSports.tv's coverage of tonight's Rocky Mountain Roller Girls game here at the Fillmore Auditorium. Again, my name is Ms. Communication.
And I'm Postal Service.
And we will be back after the short break.
Sticker Giant helps people make great stickers. I'm John Fisher, and I started the company. Every sticker has a story behind it. Every sticker has something behind it besides just stickiness.
People seem to flock towards stickers no matter what they are all about.
It's a portable billboard. It can go anywhere.
Seeing stickers on little girls' foreheads.
Cars, motorcycles.
Stop signs, you know, we don't endorse that.
Baby bottoms.
I see stickers everywhere. I see stickers in my dreams.
We are a small little group of people, and we all kind of have the same vision for success.
Every person is quality minded, top to bottom. We're about getting the job done right.
The quality of Sticker Giant stickers is really fantastic. We run 3 different materials here. All of them were researched to find the best possible thing we can get.
We can get your email and process your stickers in 24 hours and get them out to you.
We try and do things quickly, we try and do them accurately, and we try and get people the stickers that they want. People ask me what I do, and I go, we make stickers all day. There's this company in rural Boulder County, and all they do is make stickers and labels. What makes Sticker Giant a great sticker? What the customer wants, because we can print any kind of sticker. Every day there's a sticker to where I see it, and I just want to know the story behind it. I want to know the company. I want to talk to the owner.
We take people's passions, things that they're really fired up about. We make it over and over and over so those people can tell their story to the world.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're gearing up for our second period of play.
Hey, Chris.
We have to apologize, we lost the presenter bowl, so we're down to the one scoreboard outside turn number one there. But as you can see, the Red Riding Hood have a 2-point lead, 102 to 100. To start off our second period of play, number 44, Shredder Weeks will jam for the Red Riding Hood against number 22.
We are back here in the second half. Again, I'm Ms. Communication.
And I'm Postal Service.
You're tuning in to Rocky Mountain Roller Girls action here at the Fillmore Auditorium. We'll have some stats for you from the first half here in between jams. Phantom Menace with the star on her helmet for USPS. She's up against Shredder Weeks.
Phantom Menace was definitely the high scorer in the first game. Oh, she just got lead.
Shredder Weeds out and looking to spoon with Menace. Get it, cereal spoon.
USPS have themselves a goat in the back. Oh.
Phantom Menace hits the pack, gets bumped off the track.
Phantom Menace hitting the pack, but Shredder Weeds as well, picking up 3 points. We haven't had that score go up for USPS in that last jam.
Yes, they did not score. Phantom did not score any points in that last jam.
3-0. Two points. 3-2 in that last jam. Red Riding Hood's out on top. 105-102. Fielding Havoc in red up against Devastator.
Havoc is through and out. She is going to be lead jammer. Oh, and it looks like Devastator is going to the penalty box for a back block major. Or back block. I'm so used to calling them majors.
That's so 3 years ago.
It's so 3 years ago.
You hipster.
I'm such a hipster.
5 points in the air for Havoc as Mistress Terrible being sent to the penalty box. Havoc slamming into the U.S. Pummeling Service defense. Blah, 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 saying, you shall not pass. And a little hammer and nail from Pixie Your Battles. But Havoc out. She's going to pick up another 5 points.
Again, that's more that really quick, effective offense there by the Hoods.
10 points now in with that power jam in play. Devastator re-entering with the star cover in her hand. You'll see her, though, at the back of the pack. Red Riding Hood's not being fooled, not even a little.
They're not amused. She is through. She skipped up the inside there.
Havoc still on her third scoring pass. She is going to call off the jam and receive another 5 points. 15-point jam for the Hoods. Brings us 120 to 102. Red Riding Hood's on top. Benefit of a rebuilding year for USPS. They haven't won a game yet this year in the home season or in the home team tournament against Denver Roller Derby. So USPS really out there to win it. Lou Shelley on the line, number 813, up against Harper Bazaar in red.
Oh, Harper Bazaar thought she had an easy path up the outside, but Love Hurts said, no, no.
Love Hurts just getting in the way.
Sometimes it's good just to be a big, powerful cone.
Big hit around turn two. Neither jammer out yet. Harper Bazaar gets out, but because she had the star in her hand, she is an inactive jammer when she caused that pass. So not lead, but ready to score. Blue Shelley, though, still in the fray, could have the jammer available to her.
She has the undivided attention of three of the Hoods. Oh, that was beautiful, though. There was a beautiful star pass there. Titan AM was able to stealth around the outside, put the star on.
We're going to go the remaining minute and 1 second left in this jam. Harper completing her first scoring pass. She's going to pick up 4 points. Titan IAM in the fray again, wearing the star now after receiving that star pass. four more points for USPS. We're even right now in this jam. Oh my God! Bizarre out, ready and ready to put four more points on the board. Harper Bizarre going to look for that extra point pass, but Love Hurts looking to get in the way.
There's a beautiful little two wall holding back Titan IM. It looked like a old school couple skate there for a minute.
Triple shot Misto, Love Hurts, and someone with a temporary number on the back of their shirt. Looking to block, triple shot Misto with the waterfall, has to let her go. We've got a misconduct being assessed.
Lots of nice friendly high fives between teams here, between jams.
12-7 in that marathon jam. Red Riding Hood's capitalizing on it. 132-109, 25 minutes remaining. We've got a team timeout being called by the USPS. This is the first team timeout.
Oh, you're right, it is.
Each team receives three timeouts to use how they like throughout the course of the game. So now USPS with two left. And, of course, we have those official reviews reset for both teams here for the second half.
Phantom Menace doing a little power posing there before the start of this jam. It's been scientifically proven to raise your levels of testosterone.
Actually, holding your arms above your head is a power move in the yoga and the Tai Chi. When you do that, it opens the energy from the top of your fingers all the way down to the tips of your toes. It's actually a really great strategy to use instead of bending over and trying to catch your breath, because it also straightens out your lungs and your diaphragm, and so you can get deep breaths. So whether it's spiritual and or physical, the power move is to put your hands above your head when you're catching your breath or looking to focus yourself to get into the next jam. Phantom Menace, Harper Bizarre getting that misconduct penalty at the end of the jam. She is going to be caged. And Phantom Menace now owning a power jam and lead jammer status.
She gets a lead jammer status.
I'm sure Phantom Menace is not going to mind having this jam all to herselfsies for 30 seconds.
And selfsies definitely work. 5 points for Phantom Menace. USPS causing the pack to stop between turns one and two. Harper Bizarre, though, back in the fray. 5 total power points for USPS. Stopping the pack, not working in their advantage in that case.
5 more points for Phantom Menace.
And Harper Bizarre coming in hot. She's going to pick up a back block penalty.
For the ladies in blue, we've also got a back block.
Phantom Menace fighting up to the top of the pack, but motor butts going for the hit. We've got a 1-2 punch there, and Phantom Menace calls off the jam. 4 points, 14 points. 4
minutes. Takes the score to 123.
I'd say she's happy with that. Right now we're standing at 132 for the Red Riding Hoods and 124 for the USPS.
That fifth jammer lap point being added there at the end. 15 points for Phantom Menace. Phantom Menace definitely multiple scoring passes, regardless of whether or not she's the only jam on the jammer out there.
Yep, go big or go home.
Devastator in for this second power jam in a row for the ladies in blue.
Still fit for 30 seconds.
Red Riding Hood's losing a blocker to the penalty box for 30 seconds.
It's just a tornado of hood blockers up there.
Well, you know, we can't have tornadoes in Colorado.
Yeah, no, that doesn't happen.
Harper Bizarre back in. Tater just now becoming lead jammer. Another swing from the Red Riding Hoods. Tater out in lead, but no points on that power jam. Harper Bizarre getting nudged to the outfield. She is out and ready to score. Tater right now thick in the fray. She gets nudged to the outfield.
Hits the pack, hits the trap.
And Assault and Peppa being sent to the penalty box for a 30-second sit. Total of 3 points on that jam for Tater. 132-127. 5-point lead for the Red Riding Hoods.
This seems to be the game of chipping away, or this seems to be the half for chipping away. A few points here, a few points there. For those of you who are watching our first half, Lizzie Borden did go down with a minute left in the first half. She is on her bench with skates on, so we are assuming the injury is not too horribly bad, but of course we haven't seen her play yet. Titan I Am with the star in blue, but Shredder Wheat's out in front. Lead jammer for the Red Riding Hoods.
Titan I Am is waving a helmet cover. It looks like she has passed it.
In the meantime, we've got a cover.
And that handoff to triple shot, Misto. Misto out and ready to score 4 points for Shredder Wheat. You know, I kind of wonder sometimes, I'm going to go out on a limb. This is a limb, folks. I hope it doesn't break. We've seen a lot of star passes with the recent fix to the star pass rule. I am still wondering, it seems to me that defense not really happening when those star passes happen. In the pack, we're still seeing people kind of lay off of that star pass, and oftentimes the star pass is effective to stop the bleeding very quickly.
Yes, I would agree. I think it's just ingrained in our muscle memory to chase the star, and if the star is in a hand, we kind of forget that it's there, kind of. Nice recycling there by the Hoods. Phantom Menace going all the way back. When I was talking about chipping before, that is the exception, of course, to the 19-point jam that Phantom Menace put up.
And for the first time tonight, we've got Blue Scream of Death, and she is out, and for the Red Riding Hoods. Menace, though, out and hot on her heels. We are not going to have to wait 24 months for that movie to open. The wait is over. 2 points for Blue Scream of Death. Score now 138-127, 20 minutes left in the game.
20 minutes to go.
11 points. That's like a jam.
Or half a jam.
Or half a jam. Yeah, exactly.
Blue Shelly on the line up against Havoc in red. Blue Shelly hiding behind Havoc?
Yeah, that didn't work. So call that drafting. It sounds a little stronger than hiding, but yes, that's what she was trying to do. And sometimes it works. I mean, if the team can't close the hole fast enough, may as well use the same hole.
But in that case, I think it was like me hiding behind an aspen tree.
Yeah.
Havoc with a lead jammer status. Blue Shelly still getting called on a forearm penalty. We have a power jam advantage to Red Riding Hoods, and the Red Riding Hoods with that 9-point lead right now. Havoc getting knocked to the infield by Love Hurts. Great stop there by the Red defense. Triple shot Misto looking to build a line, maybe even make a little brace, but no brace with Love Hurts. Assault and Peppa, though, in there, looking to show them who's boss.
Nice bridging by Dopamine. She got a few good hits in there, too. Love Hurts and triple shot Misto drawing that all the way back.
Havoc coming back to turn one. Love Hurts. Love Hurts with a single hit. Triple shot Misto backing it up, forcing the re-entry even further around the apex.
Looks like Blue Shelly is going back to the penalty box. She actually cut a few people when she re-entered from the penalty box, so she is going to have another little sit. It seems like the Hoods have also been kind of dominating this half in terms of lead jammer.
5 power points for Havoc.
The Red Riding Hood's going to start off in a power jam situation.
Hood's with 4 lead jammer statuses. 3 lead jammer statuses for the USPS, but one of those being lost.
That's right.
Not one of those being lost to the penalty box. And out in front, we've got...
She's your lead jammer.
We've got She Who Cannot Be Named, your lead jammer in this power jam for the Hoods. And She Who Cannot Be Named through like she's risen from the dead. 5 points.
It says Horcruxes, man. They're everywhere.
Yes. Many, many Horcruxes for She Who in Derby. Blue Shelly back in from the box. Damage, though, already being done.
Oh, Blue Shelly is going to be going to the box for a third time for a back block.
3 to Blue Shelly.
three penalty box trips in a row for Blue Shelly. According to my unofficial scribblings, though, she did not have any penalties last half, so she's still doing okay counting up to seven.
Yes, that is what I have as well.
Shihu, though, through again. She's sitting on 10 points right now, and she'll put up another five, call off the jam, and we're going to have a power start for the Hoods as Shredder Weeds putting on that star. Score now 158-127, less than 17 minutes ticking down on the clock.
The USPS hasn't been able to put up any points in the past three jams because Blue Shelly has been chilling her wheels in the penalty box.
Well, then the previous two jams, when Menace jammed and then Titan slash Misto, I mean, we've had quite a few scoreless jams for USPS, and the score does show that. 15 points for She Who Cannot Be Named in that last jam. Not an insurmountable lead, though, especially not with Menace out there and her. I like to skate in circles very quickly.
Yes, yeah, she's having a great game.
Phantom Menace, of course, one of our sisters on the mic here at ColoradoSports.tv. We are thankful for you folks that are tuning in tonight on ColoradoSports.tv. We do have a donate button on the website, should you so wish. We provide this to you for free, but it does cost us a little bit of money. So if you'd like to float us $5, we'd like that. If you'd like to give us all your money, we would love you forever.
We'll take it.
We will take that.
And LP is lined up right in front of the camera line right now.
Shredder Weeds in this, a power start. We do have Blue Shelly on her feet in the box, which means less than 10 seconds are remaining on her penalty, and there she goes. Shredder Weeds up at the top of the pack. Misto, though, playing some crazy defense.
Oh,
big waterfall by Love Hurts. That's going to be a huge out-of-play call. Shredder Weeds being called lead. She thinks that the single whistle is a penalty, so she gets told to return to the track. She is lead. Red Riding Hoods are in control of the clock. Blue Shelly on the track up against number 22, Captain Crunch.
Blue Shelly, I'm sure, has PTSD from hearing whistles by now, so she is going to play this jam as cleanly and safely as she can. Jamming three times in a row is not what any jammer wants.
5 points for Shredder Weeds. It's a total of 10 right now for her. Blue Shelly out and ready to score. Probably just hoping she's putting on the pressure for the call off at this point.
In the meantime, Shredder Weeds navigates through the pack, scores four, and taps.
4 points further, 14-0 in that last jam. 172-127, Red Riding Hoods on top with 15 minutes left in the first half. Red Riding Hoods, of course, one of the original teams, home teams here at Rocky Mountain. Roller Girls, the other original team we will see a little later tonight, the Sugar Kill Gang, coming out to play the Shotgun Bettys from the Denver Roller Derby. Harper Bazaar on the line in red with the star.
And we have Phantom Menace, number 22 for USPS, and surprise, surprise, she's lead jammer. She's been doing that a lot tonight.
She knows how many points she has left to get that win. Harper Bazaar lifting up a foot. She's got the star in her hand. Menace goes ahead and hits the pack, picks up four, calls off the jam. Now, we can nickel and dime right now, but not too much nickel and dime.
Yes.
I mean, we do have less than 15 minutes left.
We want some quarters.
Give us some quarters. And we do have 41 points separating these teams. So you can't nickel and dime it too long. There's not infinite amount of time on that clock.
We're going to have Tater skating the USPS. She's going to be up against Crucial Taunt, number 9, for the Hoods.
It's Tater versus Crouton.
Oh, I'm hungry.
Both starchy and wonderful.
Yes, and I think Tater being the bigger starch, she's out first.
And Crouton going for a little jammer block there. Tater, though, up at the top of the pack, and they do force the cut on her. Track cut for USPS. That means that Crucial Taunt and the Red Riding Hoods do have a power jam. There's a minute 30 left in this jam, and we're going to go all that time.
This is all for you, Crouton. So far, the USPS has had 5 jammer penalties in the first half of this second half.
USPS playing pure.
This cannot continue if they're hoping to close up that lead.
Crucial Taunt still on her first scoring pass, and we do have Tater on her feet in the box. So great defense there by USPS. They're locking it down and hoping that the rates can be adjusted.
You're so funny, Miss C. Bob Blah Blah just brought a Crouton all the way back, opening up a nice little path.
Great penalty kill by the United States Pummeling Service. No power points in this jam yet for the Red Riding Hoods. Tater out. She was on a scoring pass. She's got 5 points now. Additional jammer lap point. Crucial Taunt looking for the handoff. She does to Major Will Payne. Payne out and ready to score. Or picks up 4 points.
Tater gets rotated to the back again. She does not look like she's having a great time right now. Oh! Triple Shot Misto tries to come back and help her out a little bit. She gets smacked a bit by Make You Pay. Oh!
Track cut for Major Lil Payne. And that, folks, is the natural conclusion of the jam. We had 4 points that Major Lil Payne was sitting on and 4 additional points for Tater. Score four. Well, we need to have that all nice and happily concluded upon as we have an official review being called. 9 points for each team, 181 Hoods, 140 USPS. I believe that official review is going to be a Hoods review. For that track. Oh, no, it is a USPS one.
That's right, Brad.
This is Skull Knockings out there, and this is terrible for the Hoods, captains, of
That's
course.
That's where we're going to go after we're done skating. Amber Bears is located at.
And it is going to be an official review for USPS.
Avenue, just around the corner.
I am not sure what USPS could be going for with Crucial Taunt already in the box, the jammer of record for that last jam.
USPS also used their official review for the last half. Who's not retained.
Remember that next weekend, all 3 of RRG's travel teams are...
Phantom Menace being swapped in for this power jam. Good call, USPS. Good call.
Yeah, yeah. She's kind of been the kryptonite for the Hood so far. I just made a Star Wars reference. I'm so proud of me.
Sweetheart, that's Superman.
Oh, just kidding. Sorry.
The Phantom Menace certainly adding to the midichlorian count for the United States Plumbing Service.
Yeah, my nerd cred is gone, man. If there was a Doctor Who theme team, we'd be good. I'd be all over this.
You'd be all over that. Yes. She would be the mistress.
Yes.
So the officials are conferring.
Officials right now conferring on that
the official review.
181-140 right now, 12 minutes left in the game. This is our first game tonight. We have a continuation of the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls series against Denver Roller Derby. We've got the Sugar Kill Gang in pink.
Let's look at the scoreboard. We got
taking on the Shotgun Bettys in pink.
Oh, interesting. It'll be like a bubblegum game.
Yes, so Sugar Kill Gang, one of the original teams. USPS, the newest team. Red Riding Hood's oldest team. And then the Shotgun Bettys are the third oldest team on for Denver Roller Derby. They were the third team added.
I love Derby history.
Yes, well, I try to keep hold of the history, and sometimes it stays in my head because, well, I was a history major, and sometimes my history professors shake their heads in shame that I can't keep things straight. And then I just say, well, it's really culture that we want to look at because that's what draws history.
Sociology.
Yes, not the wars. It's all about the culture. Phantom Menace in the crouching position. From the scoreboard, I can tell you that that official review was not awarded.
And Phantom Menace is lead jammer.
Taunt still seated in the penalty box on her penalty. Oh, I apologize. That's Major Lil Payne.
momentum and is fighting past the last little clutch of red to throw up 5 points.
Puts a grand slam on the board for USPS.
And it looks like the Hoods have their JAMA back.
5 total power points for USPS and Phantom Menace, but Phantom Menace on her second scoring cast as Major Lil Payne is out and ready to score.
Actually, that was her initial pass. She now can score a point.
Menace getting knocked to the outfield. She straddles the line and says, I won't have any of that, Peppa. I know how this works. We're teammates on Fight Club.
She knows how math works.
Yep. 10 points for USPS, 150, 181. Pippi Skull out there. Hopping up and down, getting everybody hyped. You know, sometimes when you're bench coach, you have to be team Chihuahua. And just, yeah,
they got to get their cardio in somehow, man.
Titan I Am on the line for USPS. She is up against She Who Cannot Be Named.
She Who is already towards the front. She only has 2 pummelers to get past.
Pixie in the back trying to break up that line of red that She Who Cannot Be Named out of the pack. Triple Shot Misto taking the star from Titan I Am. She's out and ready to score, and She Who says, okay, well, we can call that.
She's not greedy.
Yeah, 4 points. Misto becoming the jammer who lived. 185, 150, 10 minutes ticking down on the clock. Tater on the line up against Crucial Taunt.
Crouton Tater.
Yeah, we got the Battle of the Starches again.
Yeah.
No, Tater versus Crouton is not a salad. It is a jammer land. Sorry.
Maybe if I would have.
Oh, Crouton gets taken out. Fairly quickly to the outside. She is recycled behind Blah Blah Blah.
Devastator pushing at the front.
Tater is pushing at the front. She has 2 Hoods to get past. This is a very spread out pack.
And there we go with the out of play. Tater becomes the jammer. Crouton still stuck at the back of the pack. Blah 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 looking to write a blog after this game. She's going to knock her to the outfield.
Blah 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 wanted to back up every millimeter that she possibly could.
5 points for Devastator.
Crucial Taunt sees her way through.
Crouton out and ready to score. Now the Hood's heading up to the top of the pack, although we do have a Hood Goat at the back of the pack. Tater get knocked down, but she heads in the pack, does pick up those 4 points, 9 points.
That was like an apex turn? Not quite a jump, but she kind of like swirled the apex a little bit.
Pippi and Mistress out to call an official review for their team. Score now 185, 159, 8 minutes left in the game. Once again, thanks so much for tuning in to our coverage of the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls season. Tonight we are at the beautiful Fillmore Auditorium. The most aesthetically pleasing derby locale between the Roy Wilkins in Minneapolis and the, where is it in Bay Area? What is your
The Craneway Pavilion.
Yes. That being the prettiest one there.
Yes.
So this is how it goes for me. This is a Bay Area, pretty. Mm-hmm. Fillmore Auditorium, pretty. Mm-hmm. Roy Wilkins, pretty. And then Carolina, Raleigh.
Oh, yeah. Santa Cruz Auditorium is also very pretty.
Oh, yes.
It's another old school venue, a lot like this.
And Sacred City, of course, playing in their lovely auditorium. It's just pretty. You know, I don't mind derby in any venue.
Yes.
But
when you're in an industrial warehouse with, you know, pigeons and God knows what dusts.
But you know those LA Derby dolls, they sure can fix up a joint. They fix up their 4th joint, and man, it looks good. But that's tilty track. Back to flat track. It's like the official review. I will see if it goes away or if it stays.
Yes, there you go. Awesome. Thank you, Fillmore.
185, 159. That light is still blinking on that official review for the hoods. Hoods are going to be out of timeouts, though. They did lose that challenge, but...
Oh, Havoc earned a forearm. She looked, thought she was lead jammer. Turns out she's a forearm. She's going to go sit down. Phantom Menace is going to be her lead jammer.
Menace leads. She's up at the top of the pack. Gets past Motorbot. 5 points.
This jam might be a sequel of Phantom Menace's previous jams.
I will say this about Phantom Menace. She's a better sequel than some other ones that she might be referencing.
Yes.
5 points up in the air. We've got 10 power points total for USPS with Havoc on her feet. Menace probably going to complete another scoring pass.
USPS
power points for the United States Pummeling Service. As Havoc is back in, she does have to pass through the pack once. Misto headed to the penalty box. Havoc out and ready to score. Menace going for 20. Menace thinking she's a jam ref, and this time she does agree with a jam ref. 19-point jam. Our score now is 178-185. 7 minutes and 22 seconds remaining in the second half. And that's what I said about nickel and diming. Why nickel and dime? When you can just send out Phantom Menace.
Yeah, and then you get a quarter.
Just
almost
under a quarter.
You know, I round up. Wouldn't that be nice if jam refs just round up?
If you're watching us for Britain, let me know. Titan I am, star in blue, but out in front and lead, that's Shredder Wheats.
Shredder Wheats had just like 2 feet up the outside that she could just trot up, seemingly invisible. And she's through again, seemingly invisible. Actually, Blue Shelly noticed she was there, but not quickly enough.
5 points on the board for the Hoods. 190, 178 right now. Are you on the edge of your seat? You didn't pay for that seat. Click on the donate button now. 5 more points for Shredder Wheats. Hoods pulling away as Titan I Am still having issues.
Shredder Wheats is like channeling. I don't know what she's channeling, but she's doing awesome. She's doing like NASCAR Derby right now. She's just lapping like crazy. She's lapping like a thirsty dog, Missy.
Titan I Am out and ready to score.
Shredder Wheats gets bumped off on the back stretch and taps the hits. Bring it close.
4 more points for Shredder Wheats. 14-0 in that last jam. Red Riding Hood's being a brother or maybe being a mother. They're staying alive. 199, 179, 20 points separating these teams with 5 minutes left here in the game.
We're going to have Tater 138 for the USPS against Blue Scream of Death. Speaking of games, she has game over on her shorts. Not quite.
Blue Scream of Death slamming into the USPS defense at the top of the pack. We've got a no pack being called, and she is going to be a lead jammer. Blue Scream of Death. We've got Tater, though, out and ready to score.
Tater break in the pack for the USPS.
Blue Scream of Death says, that's fine, we're still in the lead, and I put 4 more points up. 203, Red Riding Hood's 180, USPS, 5 minutes left in the game.
USPS.
We're going to have Phantom Menace, number 22, versus She Who Cannot Be Named, number 88.
These two, of course, teammates on Fight Club.
Both of them had lots of excellent play time there at Besterns last weekend.
Besterns was a great time. We've decided to make it annual. We're having it again next year.
Yes.
So much fun. And maybe next year I will have enough vacation time to be able to join you.
West is best, ladies and gentlemen.
Always has been, always will be. That's right, Gotham, we're coming for you.
Yes.
203, 180, 443, frozen on the clock. And by the way, this is the year that Gotham will lose, just so you know.
Yeah.
Phantom Menace versus She Who Cannot Be Named. Phantom Menace up at the top of the pack against Honey Bunches of Chokes. And Menace, lead jammer. She Who Cannot Be Named, though, with one to beat. She does get knocked to the infield, though. She'll be forced to recycle behind Misto.
Menace is through on her first scoring pass. That will be 5 points.
She Who out and ready to score. You might be able to hear that bass in the background. That's the crowd yelling Shihu. Four more points for Phantom Menace.
That was an apex jump, 4 points, so she gets a few style points there.
Grace being a setup between Blah 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 and Trick Shot Misto.
Oh, I believe that Phantom Menace just picked up a forearm penalty, so she is going to go to the box.
So this is a risk that Menace took by keeping the jam running. She was hoping Shihu would pick up the penalty.
Yeah.
5 points for Shihu cannot be named. We are going to go the remaining minute left in this jam. Shihu with Love Hurts to our Flipper to beat. She's through with another 5 points, 10 total. And at that point right there, 10-9 now in the jam for the Red Riding Hoods. Shihu with a leap. She kind of holds on to it.
Shihu jumps the apex.
Right, 5 more points for Shihu cannot be named. That's a 15-point power jam. For Shihu cannot be named as Phantom Menace back in and catching up to the pack with 26 seconds remaining in the half. Menace on a scoring pass, so we'll see points go up for her when she clears the pack.
Nice blocking there by Triple Shot Misto. She is just everywhere Shihu is trying to be. Oh, and it looks like Shihu is going to be going to the box.
4 more points for Menace. We've got a high block being called on Shihu. And we've got a power jam with 2 seconds left for Menace. She'll put up 4 points. And that jam ref will realize that it's a power jam. Hopefully she'll notice it's a power jam. Okay, 4 points for Menace. And we're going to start out a power jam for USPS. 218, 197, 2.5 minutes left in the half. Or the game. And Tater out with the star to start this power jam.
It's all Tater.
It's kind of like college for me. I had a lot of Taters in college. Devastator up at the top of the pack. Motorbutt in there to try and close it down, but unsuccessful. Lead jammer, USPS. Shihu's still seated in the penalty box. 197, 221. Tater up to the top of the pack.
USPS coming up to do a little bit of offense there. They really want Tater to be able to score as many points as possible while Shihu is down.
Shihu back in the fray. Tater still on her first scoring pass right now. Good call there. You call off the jam.
Yes.
Even though Shihu is on her initial pass, we have a minute 30 left up there. I am betting that we will see. Oh, I was betting we would see Menace, but look, it is. As we go into what could be last
Namaste away, number 30. She is not wearing her name on her jersey tonight, which is why we're doing like double takes every time we get ready to say her name.
She is up against Shredder Weeds. I would have played Menace.
Yeah, I kind of think I would have too. Unless, I mean, it's possible that Menace is just kind of wiped after this half. I mean, it's always better to have a fresh jammer.
Namaste away in the fray. Shredder Weed still fighting against Blah Blah Blah. And Titan I Am in the defense. Pixie Quick, Quick and Witty as well in there with the assist. Shredder Weed's looking for it though. Lead jammer, Red Riding Hoods. With 40 seconds ticking down on that period clock, the Red Riding Hoods are sitting pretty to win this game.
Ooh.
Braced by the Salt and Pepper.
Make you pay. Some nice partner action there.
Shredder Weeds with another 5 points. Namaste away with the star in hand. As Shredder Weeds just finds it up the infield. 5 more points for the Red Riding Hoods. Red Riding Hood's definitely setting themselves up for the league championships here at Rocky Mountain Roller Girls. Shredder Weeds again. Another 5 points. As Namaste away headed to the penalty box. She did hand off the star though to Titan I Am. Shredder calling it off. 231-202 Red Riding Hoods. Taking that knife and slicing the wolf down the middle. They're going to take the win. Red Riding Hoods definitely headed for the league championship with this win here tonight.
Red Riding Hoods really came back and dialed it in the second half. You can tell they had some thoughts and feelings expressed at halftime, and it shows.
And we do want to congratulate the Serial Sisters. Thank you so much. We love you so, so much. Honey Punches and Chokes was a veteran player when I started 8 years ago. Yeah, that's all I have to add to that because my brain gets a little crazy after that.
There's a lot going on. You're absorbing a lot of sensory information right now, Missy.
I am. I absorb a lot of sensory information. I'm going to add that to my resume.
Yes.
Absorbs a lot of sensory information. We've got the Hoods taking their victory lap. Stay tuned, folks, here on ColoradoSports.tv. We have the Battle of Pink coming up next. You see some pink shiny helmets out there. Those are the Shotgun Bettys from Denver Roller Derby. They will be taking on the Sugarkill Gang in our Crosstown Rivalry Series. We've got those championships coming up in July. So we are close, folks. We're going to take a break again. Final score, 236 Red Riding Hoods, 202 United States Pummeling Service. My name is Miscommunication.
And I'm Postal Cervix.
And we will see you shortly for Game 2.
Sticker Giant helps people make great stickers. I'm John Fisher and I started the company. Every sticker has a story behind it. Every sticker has something behind it besides just stickiness.
People seem to flock towards stickers no matter what they are or all about.
It's a portable billboard. It can go anywhere.
Seeing stickers on little girls' foreheads.
Cars, motorcycles.
Stop signs, you know, we don't endorse that.
Baby bottoms.
I see stickers everywhere. I see stickers in my dreams.
We are a small little group of people and we all kind of have the same vision for success.
Every person is quality minded, top to bottom. We're about getting the job done right.
The quality of Sticker Giant stickers is really fantastic. We run three different materials here. All of them were researched to find the best possible thing we can get.
We can get your email and process your stickers in 24 hours and get them out to you.
We try and do things quickly, we try and do them accurately, and we try and get people the stickers that they want. People ask me what I do and I go, we make stickers all day. There's this company in rural Boulder County and all they do is make stickers and labels. What makes Sticker Giant a great sticker? What the customer wants, because we can print any kind of sticker. Every day there's a sticker to where I see it and I just want to know the story behind it. I want to know the company. I want to talk to the owner.
We take people's passions, things that they're really fired up about. We make it over and over and over so those people can tell their story to the world.
Well, good evening once again, roller derby aficionados. My name is Mr. Glitter, hanging out here with Postal Cervix. How you doing?
I'm doing great. I'm ready for some more derby.
Indeed. We've got another bout coming your way, representing the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls. Wearing black, we've got the Sugar Kill Gang. They're going to be squaring off against the Denver Roller Derby Shotgun Betties. They're wearing white and pink jerseys today.
Yeah, it is going to be the battle of the pink teams.
I guess we should run off some of the rosters here. I'll start with the Sugar Kill Gang. Number 100 is Badass. Number 128 is Coco Rolla Diva. She's your captain. Number 13 is Jersey Whirl. Number 16 is Southern Discomfort. Number 215 is Sylvia's Wrath. 222 is Fallen Angel. 32 is Ho J Simpson. Number 33, Sharon Tacos. Number 4, 22 is Gagan. Number 5 is Baby Doll. 76, French Kiss of Death. 901, Violent A Salts. Number 9, 24, Shred Mosby. And DOA is The Undertaker's Daughter. They're coached by Absolute and Catholic School Cruel Girl. Sorry.
All right, and for Denver Roller Derby, the Shotgun Betties, we have 129, Shadow Cat. Number 1618, Mary Mary, Quite Contrary. Number 18, Last Warfare. Number 1898, Grace Riot. Number 20, Midge Mayhem. Number 206, Cindy Vermin. Number 212, Clam. Number 27, Pootie Tang. 36, Camilla Bloodspilla. Number 5, Boo. Number 52, Antivirus. Number 617, Kish of Death. Number 8, Charlie Foxtrot. And number 98, Luna Shovegood. She is bench managers I don't have written down. Let me see the bench managers. So it's funny, on the Sugar Kill Gang we have French Kiss of Death, and on the Shotgun Bennies we have Kish of Death.
So just a slightly international version.
A little bit,
on one squad, yeah. We've got the official house announcements going out on the track. I'm expecting a great bout, just like we had earlier on tonight. It was a back-and-forth battle with a couple of the Rocky Mountain home squads, the United States Pummeling Service, and the Red Riding Hoods back-and-forth, but in the end, the Riding Hoods pulled it out primarily based on penalties. They took advantage of a lot of the power jam situations they had, really pulled away late in the second half.
Yeah, that game was definitely a nail-biter. We had probably 5 or 6 lead changes. Both the defense on both teams was phenomenal, and there were a few amazing jammers on both teams that scored a good chunk of the points.
On the bench for the Shotgun Denny's, we've got Dirt Monkey.
All right, we should get started on this game here as soon as the team introductions are finished. Again, we are at the beautiful Fillmore Auditorium. It is a very lovely venue, and you are watching us on Colorado Sports TV, or listening to us, watching them listening to us on Colorado Sports Team T. If you have a few extra bucks that you're saving by not being here in person, hit the donate button. You are very blessed to have this service for free.
Indeed, nobody gets paid for anything that's going on here, whether it's a volunteer setting up the track, any of the skaters participating here, and ColoradoSports.tv is no exception. So to try to keep this thing going and continue to bring you this kind of action, click on that donate button and help us out. We'd love to keep bringing it to you.
All right, Sugar Kill Gang, they are doing their skate out right now.
Like you said, Postal Service, this is an absolute beautiful venue for anything, concerts, roller derby. This is actually my first time here calling bouts for derby. I've watched it, and obviously we've got all kinds of musical stuff going on, but it is just, it's amazing how you have a venue like this, and you can do so much with all the action that takes place on the floor, and somehow it is still in decent enough shape to lay down some tape and some rope and skate on it.
Yeah, this floor looks suspiciously pristine considering how much roller derby is played on it, so I need to find out what it is and put it all over my house immediately. See Shred Mosby out there, one of my favorite sassy skaters. There's been a lot of excellent sports ladyship tonight, too. Lots of high fives between the teams, between jams. You can tell all these skaters know each other really well, and roller derby is a fantastic community.
Yeah, and especially here. You know, the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls and Denver Roller Derby are really only separated by a few miles here in town. That means they all know each other. They've hung out. They've skated on certain teams, and so that creates two things. That creates that rivalry, but also at the same time, it's one of those really great rivalries in sports, because they both want to compete. They both want to beat each other, but at the same time, they're slapping fives. They're laughing. Everybody's having a great time.
Looks like we are going to have Grace Riot.
And Sharon Tacos, number 33, is going to wear the star for the first jam of the bout for Rocky Mountain.
Lining up for our first jam.
Oh, looks like we're going to have some hipster derby. Everybody starting at the pivot line for funsies. There's a lot of pink out there.
Oh, man.
We got a whole lot of pink out there, even if.
And we are now in Derby Town.
Very tight pack. Some really good lateral movement going on there.
Indeed. Sharon Tacos bumped off there. Tried to find a seam on the inside.
Yeah, it looks like Grace Riot was bumped to the outside. Oh, I see the refs are calling Grace Riot on a track cut.
So that's our first penalty. Our first lead jammer call goes to Sharon Tacos for the Sugar Kill Gang.
Oh, and she is through again. 5 points. First blood. Tacos is coming through on another scoring pass. Grace Wright is still seated in the penalty box, so it's going to be more than 10 seconds.
Sharon Tacos is bumped off on the backstretch. I see some of her blockers looking over their shoulders, watching to see when Grace Riot is released. They've already got the laser-guided missiles.
And Grace Riot is released, and she's going into the waiting arms of the Sugar Kill Gang. Sharon Tacos hit to the inside, has to recycle to the back again. Is almost at a standstill. Neither jammer is really able to get a whole lot of ground here. Oh, it looks like Grace Riot hit out and recycled to the back again. Oh, I see a whistle being blown. Someone is being waved off, and Grace Riot is going to be going for another track cut penalty.
Indeed, her second penalty so far. Sharon Tacos is just having as much trouble as she can take with this Shotgun Betty's defense. She finally taps those hips, decides, I'm working too hard for this being the first jam of the bout.
She was able to get another 5 points there, so that is going to be 10 total points for the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls Sugar Kill Gang, skating in the black, for those of you that are just joining us.
Rocky Mountain's going to start off in a power jam situation with Grace Riot still hanging out in the penalty box, and O.J. Simpson, number 32 for the Sugar Kill Gang, is going to work for the ladies in black and pink.
And she is going to have the first part of this jam all to herself. It looks like the pack was trying to take off a little bit. A bit of a tumble there going into turn two. Nice three wall of sugars there at the front.
Looks like a multiplayer block is called on the Shotgun Bettys. That's Cindy Berman heading to the penalty box for Denver in the meantime.
Nice two wall of Bettys there in the front.
Indeed.
Giving Hojay the business.
Grace Riot's out of the penalty box, through the pack, and she's lead jammer. Great penalty kill there by the Shotgun Bettys.
Yeah, that was fantastic defense by the Bettys. Grace Riot trying to score some points now.
Gagan and Baby Doll looks like playing the defensive front there for Sugar Kill Gang.
Gagan was all over Grace Riot in the back, but she is around the outside, and 5 points. Man, that second turn must be slippery or something. There's been a lot of pileups there so far.
It sure has. Strong defense there at turn two by the Shotgun Bettys. They're relentless.
We saw this in the first team, too. These team two leagues must be doing a lot of wall practice. Oh, and Grace Riot slides on through. She gets another 5 points.
which gives us a tied game.
So now we have a tied game. We have 10 to 10, 10 for the Sugars, 10 for the Bettys.
Sugar's still struggling to get their jammer out on the initial pass. They've actually done a star pass, so for the Sugar Crew, being Violent Assaults is now your jammer. And that jam comes to an end, so a good rally there in jam number two by the Shotgun Bettys. They leapfrog on the scoreboard. They've got a five-point lead now, 15 to 10.
That was a 15-point jam for Grace Riot. So as of right now, Denver Roller Derby's Bettys are in lead with 15 points to Rocky Mountain Roller Girls Sugars with 10.
Looks like Camilla Bloodspill is wearing the star for the Shotgun Bettys, and Fallen Angels going to work for the Sugar Kill game.
Nice.
Fallen Angel bumped off at the pivot line. He's got to go back to the jam line.
That was a very spread out track.
Mm-hmm. Camilla Bloodspill finds her way through. Lead jammer status goes to Denver. She quickly makes her way through on a scoring pass for five more big points for the Shotgun Bettys. Star pass there, so it looks like Coco Rolla Diva had the star at the very end of that jam when it was called off.
Looks like
No, go ahead.
Looks like we're going to have tacos again for the Sugars. And we are going to have Pudetang for the Bettys.
Second time out there for the Sugars. Jamming for the first time tonight, number 27, Pudetang.
Pack is starting at the pivot line yet again.
Mm-hmm. Kind of a tale of two separate, two separate tales, I guess is what I should say. Sugar Cooking started out strong in the first jam, and from then, maybe Denver had to settle down a little bit, and they found their momentum. They're shut out Rocky Mountain since that first jam.
Looks like it's going to be Pudetang, number 27, for the Shotgun Bettys.
Yeah, Sharon Taco's hot on the trail, wants to really aggressively pursue that jammer.
Mm-hmm. And we saw that effective in the first game, too. If the not lead jammer can speed up enough, you can force the other jammer to call it off, hopefully either before she scores any points, or you may get a few, too. Looks like we're going to have 3 points there for the Bettys.
Didn't look like the Sugar Hill Gang tallied any points, but, you know, Postal Service, you hit a good point. It's one of those things that I really love about roller derby. Sometimes a jammer doesn't make it through as a lead jammer, and they tend to kind of hold up a little bit, or they're a little discouraged. But what we've seen is, even though they aren't lead, they still want to bust through and aggressively attack the situation and try to cause as few points to be tallied by the other team as possible.
Yeah, never want to dial it in, even if you're not lead.
Exactly.
Another really tight, slow-ish pack. It looks like the jammers are able to speed it up a little bit here. Pojay only had one to beat. She got recycled to the inside. She has to go back. Vermin is trying to make her way up the inside line. She's got two more to go. Shred Mosby giving her the business there at the front. And Vermin is going to be lead jammer. That is the fourth lead jam in a row for Denver Roller Derby Shotgun Bettys.
OJ Simpson still just fighting through, trying to muscle, trying to use finesse, anything that she can, and it's just not working out for her as the Shotgun Bettys even get the back block called. So OJ Simpson is going to head to the penalty box for 30 seconds for the Sugar Crew game.
So this is going to be a power jam for Denver Roller Derby Shotgun Bettys. Vermin is going to have the next 30 seconds all to herself.
We saw in our first bout just how big of a role the penalties played. So, especially, it's still early, but it's not too early to start building some momentum and building a good lead.
I love watching the pack like quickly discuss and then start to get in formation. A little tussle there between Shred Mosby and I can't quite see her number from here. I need new glasses. and it looks like Vermin gets 5 points.
5 points and taps the hips. So We're at the 21-minute mark here in the first half. Rocky Mountain Roller Girls Sugar Cookies started out really strong that first jam. They took a quick 10-0 lead. Since then, it has been all Shotgun Bettys representing Denver Roller Derby. They scored 37 unanswered points. Current score, 37-10.
We are going to have Grace Wright jamming for the Bettys.
And that is number 222, Fallen Angel, wearing the star for the Sugar Kill Gang.
Looks like Fallen Angel is closer to the front. She has a three wall to contend with. And she's a jam.
Yeah, that penalty trimmed it down to a two wall. That gave her all the space she needs, and so that breaks the streak. Sugar Kill Gang now has lead jammer status since the first jam of the bout. Star pass takes place there. Shotgun Bettys passed it off to number 212 Clam. Fallen Angel scores some points and calls it off.
We are going to have 36 Camilla Bloodspiller.
And Sharon Tacos for Sugar Kill Gang.
There's been a lot of starting at the pivot line so far.
Yeah, there really has. I'm surprised.
Yeah, I'm kind of curious. If you have both jammers and your teams are fairly even, I don't really know what the strategical advantage of that is. It seems like you're giving those jammers a lot of room to work with.
Yeah, they get a full head of steam before they hit the pack. Camilla Bloodspilla sees her way through on the inside path, and she is your lead jammer. Sharon Tacos, in the meantime, gets through as well, so both jammers looking for points.
And you can see the Bettys are trying to set up a little wall. They don't want the Sugars to be able to run away and race and deny their jammer those points that she so desperately wants.
Yeah, good move there.
Mm-hmm.
Sylvia's Wrath with the hits there that causes the call-off. Sometimes the jammer gets tired, taps the hips, doesn't want to play anymore. Sometimes a blocker does something extraordinary to make it happen, and that's what Sylvia's Wrath did. That move.
All right, we are going to have number 27, Pootie Tang, with the Bettys.
Looks like Hoje Simpson going back to work for the Sugar Kill Gang.
Looks like Pootie Tang was trying to draft off of Hoje a little bit there. Did not quite work, so she is trying again, trying to go up the middle. Oh, but it looks like Hoje is going to be, oh, excuse me, that's Pootie Tang, going to the penalty box.
It's a back block called on her. So good opportunity for the Sugar Kill Gang to try to get some momentum back and close this gap, which is currently 25 points.
Nice defense there at the front. Shotgun Bettys are giving Hoje the business. Hoje being nice and conservative. She doesn't want to cut anybody, so she's making sure she goes all the way back, keeps an eye out.
Yeah, last thing you want to do when you finally get a power jam is to have a penalty of your own to negate it.
Yes. Don't want to set her free.
Okay. Hoje, though, gets through, has that lead jammer status now. A little bit more control for her on this penalty.
Sugar Kill Gang are all walled up. That was some very nice defense right there by the Sugar Kill Gang. Or offense, excuse me.
Mm-hmm.
Baby Doll opened up a nice little hole for her jammer.
And OJ takes advantage of that. That's a point tally and a hip tap. Looks like 5 points are going to go up top for the Sugar Kill Gang. It's now a 20-point bout, so slowly trying to chip away, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Looks like we are going to have a new jammer for the Shotgun Bettys. That is Kish of Death.
Uh-huh. Yeah, Fallen Angel returning to the line.
While jamming for the first time for the Bettys, it's number 617, Kish of Death.
Looks like everybody's holding hands and bracing arms. They are ready to go. Fallen Angel goes up the inside. She is going to be lead jammer.
Kish of Death, though, struggling. She's been bumped off a couple times and had to recycle back. It looks like a track cut is going to be called on Kish, so she's going to go all the way around the track to the penalty box. Another power jam situation for Sugar Kill.
She realized it at the last second. You could see she was like, oh, God, no, and she tried to step back out, but it was too late.
Story of my life.
Yep.
Right before something bad is going to happen, I realized I shouldn't have done that.
Yep. Important thing is you learn from it.
Sometimes. Fallen Angel, 5 points, and all of a sudden we've got the momentum shift in favor of the Sugar Kill Gang as another penalty called against against
that
the shotgun.
That would be Boo. Yep. Number five. That is Boo.
Boo.
Five more points for Fallen Angel. Oh, and it looks like Kish of Death is out. She's hoping to sneak in and get a little stealth jammer action, and it totally works. She goes up the outside unseen. That was her initial pass, however, so she's not getting any points for that. Fallen Angel trying to pass those last two skaters before Kish is able to score, and it worked.
Looks like she got four. A 19-point jam for Sugar Kill Gang.
Nice.
All of a sudden, we're down to a 5-point deficit with just about 15 minutes to go here in the first half.
We are going to have another matchup of Tacos versus Grace. Grace Tacos.
Grace Tacos.
About halfway through our first period of play.
Looks like Tacos got through in second. She's late.
I'm wondering, Postal, if the Sugar Kill Gang hasn't figured something out, because they had some struggles with the defense the Shotgun Bettys were putting up earlier. The last few jams, that jammer is flying through the pack and getting lead jammer.
They're doing some really well-timed offense. Like, when I skated frequently, we would always try and designate like one person in the scrum line to help the jammer get through, and everyone else just focuses on the other jammer.
Gotcha.
And that was really helpful a lot of times, because, you know, everyone's focusing on the shiny object, and
sure.
Sometimes you don't see that blocker coming in to help her jammer out. Okay, so we are going to have Camilla Bloodspilla for the Shotgun Bettys. And that is number 32. That is OJ Simpson.
OJ Simpson, yeah. Another start there at the pivot line.
I'm going to have to ask them what that means. Like,
yeah.
Are we just getting a little variety? I don't know. All right, Camilla. Camilla Bloodspilla, Shotgun Bettys, Lee Gemma.
Well, one thing that I saw in some of the bouts that have been taking place over the last couple of weeks, you touched on it earlier, is it seems like both of these teams, both of these leagues, the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls and Denver Roller Derby, seem to really be cranking down and focusing on defense. I don't know if this is maybe something to do with that.
Oh, we're going to have a forearm call on Camilla Bloodspill. This is going to be a power jam for Koj Simpson. And we only have a 1-point difference in this game right now, so we might be seeing a lead change here if you're drinking at home. Now's a good time. Well, in a second. Oh, I see the helmet cover has come off, and it looks like we are going to have a star pass.
We are. That's Jersey World. The pivot has it in her hand, but she gets bumped off, has to recycle all the way back to the pivot line to go back to work.
That was some quick eyes there by the Shotgun Bettys. We saw in the last game there were a few star passes where the pack didn't quite catch on quick enough and some bleeding was stopped. But we are going to have 5 points for Camilla Bloodspiller.
So a great penalty kill there by the Shotgun Bettys. It's got to be disheartening if you're a jammer. You hand the star off to the pivot, and the pivot has the exact same amount of trouble that you had.
Yep.
You thought maybe you had something that was going to work.
Yep. Shadow Cat did an excellent hit there to the inside a second ago. Knocked Ho-J down. That's always the dream when you go for a big hit. You want it to work. She continues to give Ho-J Simpson a little bit of business at the front. Midge Mayhem came up to help her out.
So just about 12 minutes in the first half, Denver Roller Derby, Shotgun Bettys 49, the Rocky Mountain Roller Girl Sugar Kill Gang 43. Check that, they have just tallied one more point for Shotgun Bettys, so it is 50-43, a 7-point deficit. We got a timeout on the track. Looks like that timeout is being called by the Sugar Kill Gang. Postal Service, in a situation like this, as a skater, you know, if you were wearing the black and pink, you're on the Sugar Kill Gang, you call a timeout. Is there anything that you are accustomed to hearing? You're going to be chewed out? Is there something that you want to hear? You know, what would you expect from a timeout in this scenario?
Well, the Sugar Kill Gang, actually, their jammers are doing a better job of staying out of the box, so that's not especially a worry. They're probably discussing maybe a change in like their wall formation, or maybe they're kind of starting to pick up on some of the tricks that the Shotgun Bettys are pulling out. Usually you see the biggest difference in play after halftime when the teams have like 30 entire minutes to sit and talk, but these timeouts are really valuable just to kind of break up the momentum, touch base a little bit, and if the jammer can communicate to her blockers what she wants them to do to maybe get her through a little quicker. Because if you can get lead jam before turn one, that's the dream.
Absolutely.
Especially since these teams usually play like a three-jammer rotation, maybe with a fourth jammer thrown in for relief. So, you know, in the second half, you're getting a little tired if you're getting beat up for 20 feet.
Sure. Sure. So maybe this quick timeout, because maybe you got a few lineup changes here and there, maybe a blocker gets switched out for somebody else, and just maybe get everybody back on the same page. Huh?
Yeah, maybe adjust the lineups a little bit. Maybe certain combinations of players are more effective against certain jammers. Jammer matching, perhaps, putting different jammers up against. Sharon Tacos is going to be lead jammer. Pootie Tang, it looks like, is still contending with the Sugar Kill Gang. She is now out.
Fast-moving pack here at turn four. Sharon Taco zigs and zags. She jukes and she jives. And going backwards tallies 4 points for the Sugar Kill Gang before she puts an end to this chapter.
Saw Taco's glancing at her jam ref to confirm that she was lead before she began calling off that jam.
It's like we're having a rematch, Fallen Angel versus Grace Riot. We've seen this at least once before, maybe twice.
It's Grace and Angel.
Grace and Angel.
Grace
wow.
and Angel. Angel Grace.
But they've both got that violent aspect of that other part of their name. There's the Riot for Grace Riot, the Fallen for Fallen Angel.
Fallen Riot. I'm mesmerized by Grace Riot's skates. They're so pretty. They're so pink. Grace Riot trying to sneak by on the outside. Looks like Angel's trying to go up the middle. Great defense here by both packs. We're out of turn two. That was gorgeous.
Yeah, that was Shadow Cat. Nice work there. She was the last line of defense, made it count, and Fallen Angel couldn't do anything in that situation to call it off.
And that's the thing. It's like, even if you only have one more foot to go after the jammer, go ahead and go after the jammer, because as you can see, it works, especially when the jammer's going into a turn. That's when physics is in your favor if you're hitting a jammer to the outside.
Absolutely. So Sharon Tacos, number 33, familiar territory for her on the jam line for Sugar Kill Gang. It looks like, what is that, Camilla Bloodspilla for Shotgun Bettys.
Oh, a little bit of leapfrog there. Camilla recycled to the inside, has to go back by Gagan, draws her back. Violet Assault, Gagan, and Shred Mosby making a little tripod in the back. Sharon Tacos recycled to the back, and it looks like there might, there's going to be a star pass.
Indeed, that's Gagan. As an announcer, looking at her from distance, I appreciate the jean shorts. I can spot her really easy. Yep. She was the pivot, now she's the jammer.
Points for Camilla Bloodspiller. So we are at 54 points right now for Denver Roller Derby Shotgun Bettys versus 47 points for Rocky Mountain Roller Girls Sugar Kill Gang.
She will face
Pootie Tang and Fallen Angel. Fallen Angel not getting much of a break. I think we just saw our two jams ago, so they pretty much said, catch your breath, you're going right back out.
This is why I could never do a juice cleanse. How do you skate like this on nothing but juice? I'd be eating entire cows before games like this.
You'd have to change your name to Hangry.
Yes.
You know?
I wonder if that's taken. That's a good name.
Yeah, it isn't.
Look at that defense.
Ooh. Nice contact there at turn two, and Jersey Whirl has to recycle way back.
Very stretched out pack.
This is the part where you cheer for defense,
there's been a lot of well-timed offense in this game, too. We saw that in the last game as well. Sometimes it just takes one friend to hit one person to make your life easier. Coco Roller Diva and Jersey Whirl squeezing every last drop of aggression out on Pootie before they finally have to let her go. Pootie is lead. Is that? Wow, they've been holding onto those jammers that entire time.
Yeah, Fallen Angel yet to make her way through on her initial pass.
Pootie is looking to score. I did see her hips go past that wall. She is through, 5 points.
In the meantime, Kish to death. Bumping Fallen Angel off at about the pivot line. Fallen takes the cover off. She's thinking about a pass. I can't blame her. She's been getting beat up this gym.
Yeah, these bloggers mean business. You can definitely tell everybody's all doing CrossFit and eating paleo now. These blockers are no joke.
We do have that star pass we were talking about. Coco Roladiva now putting the star on for the Sugar Kill Gang.
Nothing like a fresh jammer. Oh.
I guess Fallen Angel decided she wanted to be on the other side of those hits. She went ahead and put a shoulder in at the end of that jam.
And Coco Roladiva was able to get 1 point there, and Pootie was only to get two, so. Ah, speaking of jammers not getting much of a break, Tacos is back out. And she is going to be going up against, that is Vermin. Haven't seen Vermin in a little while.
And you know, now that I look at the rosters, I think they have actually only been going out there with two jammers. The Sugar Kill Gang, that is. Sharon Tacos gets the lead jammer status.
Vermin is behind her, trying to make up a little bit of ground here. Pack is braced for impact.
Oh.
Nice hit there by the inside. I didn't see who did that, but Sharon Tacos went up flying. And that is 4 points for Tacos, 0 points for Vermin.
So I guess a quick update. I did see that the Sugar Kill Gang is going with a three jammer rotation. Fallen Angel, Sharon Tacos, and OJ Simpson, who's on the jam line right now. Looks like we got an official timeout on the track. Do some track repair. Get that roll of tape out there and make sure that the rope underneath it doesn't come loose.
Announcers are getting a little love there by Shred Mosby. She's so sassy. I love her. So the nice thing is when the officials have a timeout, both the teams basically get a free one.
Mm-hmm.
So they can reassess their stuff a little bit. And it always gets kind of tricky with jammers too, because if you have like one or two really, really effective jammers and their style of jamming just devastating the other team, you want to play them a lot, but you want to play them too much because you don't want them to get hurt or worn out or start picking up penalties because they're having to skate every other jam. So it's a very delicate balance.
Right, right. Because, yeah, you're exactly right. The more you work these skaters, the more you have potential for injury or just getting burned out. But, you know, when you got somebody on a hot streak, you want to roll it and just see how far you can push it.
Yeah.
Track repair is done. So Grace Riott versus OJ Simpson.
Pile up there in the middle going into turn one, but Grace Riott is out. She is going to be lead jammer.
Sharon Tacos bumped off nicely. That Shadow Cat making her presence felt.
Shadow Cat has had some fantastic hits so far this game.
She has. She's really stood out in this first half.
5 points for Grace Riott.
Gagan called for a penalty for Sugar Kill Gang, so there's a little bit more room to work with. In favor of Grace Riott, now that there's a blocker in the penalty box for the ladies in black.
Okay, and it looks like we're going to have a star pass for the Sugars.
But we have a back block called on Grace Riott. So we're going to flip the coin. We're going to go to full 2 minutes because we lost our lead jammer. And we're going to have a power jam in favor of OJ Simpson now and the Sugar Kill Gang.
We have a 20-point game right now. OJ is going to have a little bit of time by herself to score some points. So the Bettys are going to try and stop the bleeding as much as possible and kill that penalty time. And the Sugars are going to try and take advantage of the situation. And you can see they're not doing passive offense either. They're like right in there trying to help out. Well, I just said that and they just stopped skating.
Again, another very, very effective penalty kill by the Shotgun Bettys. They've got those four blockers just sealed up nice and tight.
Grace Riott is back into play. OJ Simpson briefly attempted to call it off. She was not lead jammer, however. She wasn't penalized for it because they didn't actually call it off. Grace gets through for 4 points.
OJ, though, called for a track cut. Sometimes the penalty is a result of a mistake. In that case, That was an earned penalty. Shotgun Betty's really strategically caused that. Congratulations to them. And that's 30 seconds in the penalty box for the Sugar Hill Gang Jammer.
Grace Wright was able to get by for 5 more points on that jam. So that was a 14-point jam for Grace Wright.
Wow. So 3.5 minutes in the first half. The Shotgun Betty's 81 and the Sugar Hill Gang 57. Seems like just as the Sugar Hill Gang gets some momentum, starts to close that gap, the Shotgun Betty's come on through and take the momentum back and make a nice wide lead again.
So far, the Sugars have had 6 lead jams, and the Betty's have had 8, so it's been fairly even considering.
It's like Camilla Bloodspilla is jamming in a power jam situation. She's now out of the pack as lead jammer.
Hojay is standing in the box now, so she will be out shortly. But Camilla is on her scoring pass.
Coco Roladiva and Sharon Tacos are the last line of defense for the Sugar Hill Gang. But to no avail, that's a big 5-point grand slam for the Shotgun Betty's.
Camilla was really smart there, too, because she noticed that the blocker that hit her out also went out, so she didn't bother coming in all the way at the end of the pack. She came in exactly where she needed to, not giving up any ground. 5 more points for Camilla. 5, yes.
Great track awareness. Looks like we've got a star pass. Sharon Tacos had the pivot on. She's now got the star, so she is the jammer for the Sugar Hill Gang.
Now, with all the star passes that are happening in this game now, it's nice to kind of have a deep bench of blocker-jammer hybrids that you can have one pivot and one jam, and they can always swap it out if they need to.
Indeed.
Oh, we are going to have Kish of Death. Kiss of Death, sorry.
Mm-hmm.
I believe this is her first time jamming.
It is, yeah.
And then we have Pootie Tang.
Yeah, the Sugar Hill Gang had been going with a 3-jammer rotation of Fallen Angel, OJ Simpson, Sharon Tacos. Now, French Kiss of Death getting a try.
A little fresh blood.
Mm-hmm.
It looks like it's going to be Pootie Tang, lead jammer.
Sugar Hill Gang blocker, Undertaker's daughter, going to the penalty box to be met shortly there by one of the Shotgun Betty's blockers.
Is looking a little anemic right now. I hear some whistles.
Track cut called on French Kiss of Death for the Sugar Hill Gang. So that jammer will head to the penalty box. Power jam situation once again for the Shotgun Betty's.
Yep, this is all Pootie Tang's jam. She is going to have the next 30 seconds all to herself to score as many points as she can. And the Sugar Hill Gang are going to do their best to kill that dream.
Undertaker's daughter served her crime, her time for her crime, gets back on the track and trying to help out the Sugar Hill Gang.
Betty's are doing a good job trying to keep the Sugar Hill Gang from reforming. They are walled up and they are ready for Pootie Tang.
Sugar Hill Gang, though, in a bunch of penalty trouble here. They've got Sylvia's Wrath and Coco Roladiva both headed to the penalty box. A lot of extra room on the track for the Shotgun Betty's. They take full advantage of that. That's 5 big points for Pootie Tang.
Kiss of Death is still struggling a little bit with that wall.
Mm-hmm. But Pootie Tang not struggling at all. She went to the pack untouched, and that's another grand slam. Make that 2. Just as I get it out of my mouth, she does it one more time.
Frenchie has called for a track cut. That is a good way to differentiate between the two kisses. Frenchie. She did not look pleased when that whistle was blown.
No, she didn't. This is not the way the Sugar Hill Gang wanted to end the first half, as the Shotgun Betty's going a huge run. A 25-point jam to close out the first half, bringing their total to 116. The Sugar Hill Gang at 57 points.
57 for the Sugar.
All right, we are going to take a little break. We will come back. We'll have some fun factoids and stats from the first half. Again, thank you for listening to us and watching them on Colorado Sports TV. Hit that donate button if you're at home and you're not having to pay for your own beer or food or ticket. I am Postal Cervix.
I am Mr. Glitter.
And we will talk to you soon.
All right.
Has been on the ref scene. He's actually higher this year than last year.
Excellent.
I was so stunned when he was on the team that awarded one at Masters last weekend.
Welcome back, folks. Halftime here with the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls Sugar Kill Gang and the Denver Roller Derby Shotgun Bettys. Your halftime score, 116-57 in favor of the Shotgun Bettys. Postal Cervix, pretty exciting first half, huh?
Yeah, definitely. I got a few fun stats for you. So far, the Sugar Kill Gang have had lead jammer 8 times. They've had 5 jammer penalties. The Shotgun Bettys have had lead 11 times, and they've had 4 jammer penalties. The difference in the score, Pootie Tang had a really nice jam there because Frenchie had a double penalty in one jam, so Pootie Tang was able to rack up like 26 points or something. And it seems like the Shotgun Bettys have just been able to leverage their power jams a little bit better.
Yeah, so that's kind of that's actually a really similar story to the first bout that we had tonight. It was, in all things, you take into consideration, it was all pretty even. Where really things got out of hand was on the penalties and who can take advantage of the opportunities.
Definitely. And with teams this closely matched, too, it can come down to timing. It can be, do you run that extra foot after the jammer? If you're not lead jammer, do you put that extra push in to try and get them to, like, call it off quickly, maybe before they can get any points, or maybe you can get a few points, too? It's like all those little things all add up and matter. As a jammer, you have to kind of decide, okay, I think I'm coming in behind the person that hit me. Do I want to be safe and go all the way back and lose ground? Or do I want to kind of take the risk and come in and potentially go to the box?
Yeah, so having said that, do you expect that either squad is going to make much in the way of adjustments, or are they just going to kind of, you know, try to manage penalties, try to find some opportunities, and then make adjustments on the fly throughout the second half?
I bet they're both coming with a little something different because, again, this is so close. They had to have something that they're taking away, and it looks like that is going to be Pootie Tang. She is going to be lead jammer for the Shotgun Bettys.
Yeah, they're going to start off, looks like, in a power jam situation because they are. The Sugar Hill Gang jammer is in the penalty box.
Yep, this is going to be a power jam for Pootie Tang.
Pootie Tang gets through for a quick 5 points on her second scoring pass. And now the Sugar Kill Gang manages to put together a nice four-wall defensive front.
That is going to be Frenchie. I apologize to Frenchie. That is an easy way. There are too many kisses in this game. It's like Frenchie is recycled to the back, as is Pootie. Pootie still has not completed that pass.
The single largest jam in the first period for the Sugar.
Yeah, Gagan and Undertaker's daughter leading that three-wall.
15-point jam by Fallen Angel.
There's Sylvia's Wrath in there, too. Now it's a two-wall with Gagan and Sylvia's Wrath. Trim down to a one-wall, and you can get through there pretty simply. That's 5 points for Pootie Tang.
Gagan was really digging in with her toe stops there. She was using physics, trigonometry, all of it. Now Gagan is going to be lead jammer.
Yeah, so your star pupil gets another assignment. Going to try to score some points for her team now that she played some defense.
It's going to be 4 more points for Pootie Tang. Gagan is through with 4 points.
So the first 4 points tallied by the Sugar Kill Gang. Pootie Tang hits it back, hits the track, and decides that's a good time to tap the hips and call it off.
Looking to see if Pootie got any more points. 4 more points for Pootie Tang. So that was a 14-point jam for Pootie Tang.
Indeed. On the jam line, we've got number 33, Sharon Tacos for the Sugar Kill Gang. And number 212, that's Clam. I believe that is her first time on the jam line tonight.
Tacos is an old veteran, though. Tacos toe stops up the inside, shoots towards the outside. She's got one left. However, Clam is going to take lead jammer.
Sharon Tacos finally finds a seam right up the middle, so she's eligible for points as Clam gets through on her first scoring pass and emphatically demonstrates that she wants that jam to end.
Yes, and Clam got 5 points there. She looked at her bench coach and got the signal to call off the jam. She was asking permission first. You never know with those bench coaches.
One thing consistently, though, that we have seen all night is really good communication, not only on the track between the skaters, but everybody seems to have somebody shouting from the bench, and familiar voices are ringing through, and everybody kind of seems to know what's going on at every point in time.
We are going to have Coco Rolodiva, number 128. I believe this is her first time jamming this game, up against Grace Riot, 1898.
Yeah, Coco's had the star on, but it was during a star pass. She was pivot. This is her first time on the line. Grace Riot gets through lead jammer once again for the shotgun Bettys.
Ooh, Coco Rolodiva almost makes it up the outside, but she gets a hit by Kish of Death, has to recycle to the back.
Grace Riot on the other side gets through, and that's a 5-point grand slam for the shotgun Bettys.
Coco Rolodiva did a little bit of a star stash. She is out, coming up on her scoring pass. Grace Riot through for another four.
Grace Riot through again for another four.
9 points. So far, the shotgun Bettys have gotten lead jammer all three jams. They have had a 14-point jam, a 5-point jam, and a 9-point jam, and the Sugars have only had a single 4-point jam.
Here's a matchup we've seen before.
If I'm mathing right.
Number 36, Camilla Ponsilla, versus number 33.
And so one of those formulas for success in roller derby is if you can be lead jammer and you can stay out of the penalty box, everything else kind of falls into place. So far, shotgun Bettys have followed that formula to a T.
Tacos is skating after just a little brief break. Camilla Bloodspilla is going to be lead jammer.
So that's four in a row for the Bettys. Sharon Tacos gets through, wants to try to put some pressure and stem the bleeding for the Sugar Kill Gang.
Camilla Bloodspilla trying to get as many points, and she's going to try. She calls it off, but I think that Tacos was able to get some points there. Looks like 2 points for Tacos, 4 points for Camilla.
So the shotgun Bettys are doing a little bit of experimenting on the jam line.
Oh yeah, that's Boo.
Sending Boo out there, yeah. OJ Simpson, number 32 for the Sugar Cook Gang. She's been out there quite a few times. So.
Yeah. That could be one of the things they talked about at halftime. You know, maybe the jammer's getting tired, maybe they want to mix it up a little bit. And again, you can have a jammer that's super effective against one team, and that style of skating maybe just isn't as effective against another team. So, you know, it's good to have a really deep bench.
Indeed. Boo met harshly there by Shred Mosley and then has to recycle back to the jam line, but she bounces back to work somehow, gets through as lead jammer.
I do love a good literary reference, Boo Boo Radley. We make him educated here in Colorado. OJ recycled to the back as well. Oh, it looks like Boo Boo Radley is going to be going to the penalty box. There's a cut.
So that's a power jam situation for OJ Simpson. She still hasn't made it through on her first pass, though. Right now, dealing with a little Kish of Death. Passed off. I believe that's Shadow Cat doing what she's done all night long.
Shadow Cat has had some amazing hits in this game. I would not want to be skating against Shadow Cat tonight. Nice teamwork there by the Bettys.
Yeah, good footwork though by OJ Simpson. Somehow, some way, she stayed on the track and got through.
Very wise. Gagan backs all the way up, forcing Boo to lose a little bit of ground when she comes in. She does not want to get another track cut. Gagan, Shred, Mosby, and Salt giving her tons of love.
On the other side, OJ Simpson has her hands full with Shadow Cat and Kish to Death, but Kish called for a penalty. And a forearm called on OJ Simpson, so another power jam opportunity for the Bettys.
Yes, and I apologize, that was violent assaults, not salts. Salt's
five
a different skater. Another five for Boo.
That's actually the first
or five for Boo.
Scoring pass in this jam, although we should now see some points.
So that 2 minutes comes to an end. 22 minutes left in this one. The Shotgun Bettys 155, the Sugar Kill Gang 68. So looks like the Shotgun Bettys have taken the momentum that they had at the end of the first half and just rolled it on over into the second half.
And it jammer for, did we lose somebody?
We did. We lost Hoji Simpson at the end of that jam to a penalty for Sugar Hill Gang. Yeah.
I was like, something doesn't look right. This is not the derby I know.
Cindy Verman is the lone jammer out there for the Bettys. She pushes through, and now she's your lead jammer.
Cocorilla Diva just did not want to let her go.
O.J. Simpson now out of the penalty box. We're back to 5-on-5 derby. Cocorilla Diva, look at that. Last line of defense, and it's 2-and-it's strong.
Her footwork is amazing.
That's a grand slam for the Shotgun Bettys.
It's good partner work there by Sylvia's Rath and Cocorilla Diva at the front.
It really was. And good communication again by the Shotgun Bettys. They signaled that there was that star pass. Now Sharon Tacos has the star. They jumped right on her and wanted to make it difficult for her.
And that star pass did exactly what they wanted it to. It forced Verman to call off the jam. So
yeah, you're seeing a lot more of that in derby these days. It's, you know, if we don't get lead jammer and our jammer doesn't get out of there right away, let's pass that star, get our pivot out there, try to cut this off and limit the amount of points that the other team can score.
Mm-hmm. Looks like we are going to have Gagan, number 422, up against Pootie Tang, number 27. I don't think Gagan has jammed so far this game.
No, she was another one that had the star on a cover pass, but she hasn't been on the line yet.
Mm-hmm. Again, nice deep bench. Up looks, Pootie is recycled to the back. Gagan is going to be lead jammer. This is the first lead jammer that the Sugars have had thus far in this half. If my calculations are correct, they might not be, because I'm watching a lot of Great Derby right now.
Well, if we're wrong together, because I think the first six went to the Bettys, and yeah, this is the first one that's gone the direction of Sugar Hill Gang.
Yeah. Gagan fighting past the last two. This is a very spread out pack. There were no bridgers, so they had to let her go. Mm-hmm. That is 5 points for Gagan. Four points for Pootie.
Gagan hits the pack and calls it off after she tallies four more points. So the Sugar Hill Gang wins that round by a score of 8-4. Still got a lot of distance to cover. 168-76 is your current score in favor of the Shotgun Bettys.
We have another DOA Undertaker's daughter jamming for the Sugars. And we're going to have Camilla Bloodspill up for the Bettys.
So, Postal, do you think the Sugar Hill Gang is trying to look for something? Is that why they're sending so many jammers out, just trying to find that recipe that works for them? Or do you think they want to get these skaters some work?
You know, it could either be that they could be saving some of their high-scoring jammers for power jams. Some of their higher-scoring jammers could be tired right now and beat up. A lot of these jammers did just skate at Besterns last weekend. And it could be exactly what you said. Again, you never know. There could be someone that doesn't normally jam as much that their jamming style just could completely work.
Yeah. Camilla Buzzbill is out, and she has made now two scoring passes. That's the one was worth five. In the meantime, Undertaker's daughter called for a track cut for the Sugar Hill Gang. She's going to hang out in the penalty box for 30 seconds, and it's going to be a power jam for the Shotgun Bettys.
Yeah, Shotgun Bettys, I'm seeing, and it's kind of obvious, I'm seeing a lot tighter defense. I'm seeing quicker transitions. Sugars actually had some really quick transitions between offense and defense in the first half, and the Shotgun Bettys have really nailed down their stuff a little bit in the second half here.
Yeah, unfortunately, a little bit of bad luck there. Camilla Bloodspill called for a track cut, so we lose our lead jammer. We're going to skate for 2 minutes. It's a power jam for the Sugar Kill Gang, and Undertaker's daughter is now tasked with attacking that tough, tough free wall she's got in front of her.
Yeah, at one point that was a four wall. I mean, when you've got that many strong skaters, she is just so happy to get out. When you have that many strong skaters digging in with the rubber and urethane of their toe stops, that is not fun to push against. Sugar, it's like a football drill.
Yeah, just tough, tough. You don't want to do it again.
Yeah.
Sugar Hill Gang looks like they want to play defense. They're going to play a passive offense style. So Undertaker's daughter is going to have to try to push up against that wall. And 2 minutes comes to a close.
See, if I were the Sugar Hill Gang in that situation and I had somebody that wasn't in my regular jammer rotation, I would have sent at least one person up to help her a little bit, because a tired jammer that's getting that shut down is more likely to commit penalties, and that can hurt you a lot more in the long run than sending one blocker to help out.
Absolutely. And you know, I guess if I get on a soapbox, you can tell me, but I like that style. I like that attacking style where the blockers help out. You know, it is a team sport, so help out your jammer anytime you can is my philosophy.
Yeah, definitely.
But maybe that's why I'm here and not on a coaching bench.
Yeah. Tacos is out. Luna Shovegood is jamming for the Bettys.
Tacos looking to start a little rally for the Sugar Hill Gang. That's a 5-point grand slam.
Nice. Luna Shovegood is still up. She is out as well.
Sharon Taco's nice footwork on the toe stops there, kind of leaning on the blocker, seeing how much ground she can make up, and then taps it out after one more point for the Sugar Hill Gang.
So we're now looking at 84 for the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls Sugar Hill Gang versus 183 for the Denver Roller Dolls Shotgun Bettys.
Kiss of Death for the Bettys and Fallen Angel for the Sugar Hill Gang. Kiss of Death just goes against the other jammer right away.
That is one nice thing about being a jammer, is you can engage the other jammer anywhere on the track you want to.
Mm-hmm.
Fallen Angel, however, is going to win this round. The lead jammer. Looks like Kish is getting recycled to the back, I think. No, never mind. She still had the... Oh, it looks like she's going to be going to the penalty box.
Penalty box.
For... something.
No signal there from the referee, but hey, it's all 30 seconds.
Yep.
We'll take a look at the power jam situation.
Yep. Another 5 points for Fallen Angel, or 5 points for Fallen Angel. Sugarcoat Gang, two blockers in the pack.
Aggressiveness there by the having Grand Slam.
Again, if you're team, she's going to be all momentum.
Absolutely.
They start getting
this little run.
14.
Yeah. Absolutely. So 183 to 98, your current score in favor of the Shotgun Bettys. We've got just about 13 and a half to go in this one.
We're going to have Violet Assaults versus Boo.
First time for Violet Assaults on the jam line today. Like an empty penalty box as well, so we're 5-on-5.
I know when I was skating too, sometimes the home teams would send in different jammers, and it was basically kind of their tryout for the travel team.
Okay.
I don't necessarily have the rosters for the travel teams memorized yet. Oh, looks like Boo's going to be lead jammer. But that could be another strategy, kind of trying people out.
Sure.
Tournament season's coming up. Good Lord, Boo Radley just slips through. She earns 5 points.
Jersey Whirl called for a penalty for Sugar Hill Gang. And that is Annie Virus going to the box for the Shotgun Bettys.
Boo gets through again. It's like no one can see her. She has like stealth technology or something right now. And through again. 5 more points.
Looking back at the pack work, you can see that the Bettys are just swarming like a hornet. Whether it's offense or defense, big transition got going on. It's done two things. It's kept Violent Assaults out of getting her through her initial pass, but it's opened up a lot of room for Boo Boo Bradley. She takes advantage of it again, and that's another 5 points.
It's like Frenchie is going to be putting on the star. Yeah, the Shotgun Bettys are doing a good job of just kind of disrupting the pack a little bit. See, now that Frenchie is in play, they can't help Boo out as much, but there's been some really good offense by the Shotgun Bettys, and Boo has scored 20 points so far in this, and she's not in their regular jammer rotation, so that just shows you how much having a little help from your friends. She's doing a fantastic job. And being a blocker, too, she's really able to kind of block her way through the pack.
Absolutely. Different style than what you used to see as a jammer, and it paid off in a big way. 25 points, Postal.
That is fantastic. That might be the highest... Oh, that was 1 point shy of the highest scoring jam in this game.
Yeah, I believe the last jam of the first half was 26, so...
Yeah.
Just as the Sugar Hill Gang finds a little momentum, starts to get their footing.
Yeah, we're now looking at a 10-point game? No. I can't do math at all. I'm so sorry. 98 versus 208. Woo! Need to drink some more caffeine. Tacos, lead jammer. This is why I don't do points tracking. Furman getting the business. Shred Mosby and Coco Rolla Diva. Coco Rolla Diva is going to the box. I think she gave a little too much too long.
Taco scores four, says we'll skate no more. That's going to put the Sugar Hill Gang over the century mark, 102. I've got a little easier math to do here.
Yes.
So it's a 106-point deficit in favor of the Shotgun Bettys.
Oh, my God, that was bad. I think they're going to take my diploma away after that.
Well, you notice I didn't even try. I think I know my limitations, so I was going to stay away, wait for the numbers to change, and then try it a minute.
You're so smart. Another new jammer. It looks like we have Mary Mary Quite Contrary jamming for the Bettys.
O.J. Simpson out there again for the Sugar Kill Gang.
Mary's already at the front.
O.J. has a tough three wall that she is battling. That is just... That's tough. That's Pootie Tang. That's Antivirus. And I believe that is Shadow Cat once again. How many times have you said that name?
Sugar's putting up an impressive defense here just with a two wall with a handy little bridger there in the middle. And it looks like Coco Rolla Diva is out of the box, so she's going to come and help her jammer with some well-timed offense and check it out. Now her jammer is towards the front. Now she got recycled back in, but... I'm sure the jammer was very grateful to Coco Rolla Diva for that. And finally, it looks like we have a lead jammer. Vermin is out. Or excuse me, that is Mary Mary Quite Contrary.
OJ just cannot find an answer for this defensive front. She sees an opening, and then that door gets slammed shut.
Yeah. They always say, go for the friendly side, but sometimes there isn't a friendly side.
Coco Rolla Diva heading to the penalty box for 30 seconds as Mary Mary Quite Contrary puts another five spot up top for the Bettys.
She is coming up again for some more points. Oh. Five more points.
Yeah, Undertaker's daughter, last line of defense, but just couldn't quite hold on.
That is a very strong three wall there. I can hear her, OJ's fans, cheering to her in the audience, telling her, it's only 15 more seconds. Keep pushing. You can do it.
She's probably thinking, easy for you to say.
Yeah. 2 minutes is a very long time. OJ is finally released from the pack. And let's see. It looks like we got five more points for Mary Mary. Was that 15? Or?
Looks like a 14-point jam.
14-point jam. So, again, someone that is not on their regular jammer rotation just put up 14 points. That was not only fantastic work by Mary Mary Quite Contrary. Again, sometimes being a blocker can be a huge advantage when you're jamming because you can block your way through. But there was some really well-timed offense in there that helped out a lot.
Absolutely. On the blocker side of things, though, a little bit of bad news for the Shotgun Bettys. There hasn't been much of it, but Kish of Death has fouled out, so she is done for the evening.
Looks like Luna Shovegood. Is that right? Yes, Luna Shovegood.
Gagan is jamming and right on her tail.
Yes. Looks like we have 4 points for Gagan.
Haven't seen a tally for the Shotgun Betties. Looks like we're not going to see one, so apparently the Shoverkill game may have won that.
Wow.
Clam tacos on the jam line.
That sounds weirdly delicious, actually.
Rare genetic abnormality resulting in 3 extra muscles in each leg.
Oh, wow, and Clam kind of gets hit forward, so she is lead jammer. That's always nice when that happens, when a hit actually helps you out.
Yeah.
It's like Tacos is still stuck in the pack. She hasn't even gotten to turn two yet. That is a really, really, really tight up, and she's out. I just helped. Clam. Oh, go for it.
Yeah, she's going up against Violet Assault's Fallen Angel. Solves that riddle and puts 5 up there for the Betties.
Oh, it looks like Sharon Tacos might be reporting to the penalty box. That might have been a last minute. No?
Well, there was definitely a pile up here, but no penalty called, at least not on Sharon.
Okay. Oh, looks like Gagan is going to be jamming again. She's been doing really well as a jammer, so.
Yeah, she has. And we haven't seen Grace Riot as much in the second half, but she took quite a bit of responsibility there in the first half.
Yes. Yeah, this is not an easy sport on your body, and this defense has not been easy to get through. It is exhausting. It's like doing CrossFit for 2 straight hours.
Gagan bumped off at the apex, goes back to work. In the meantime, it looks in a photo finish. Grace Riot is your lead jammer.
See, and in this situation, with only 4 minutes left, even though Grace Riot is lead jammer, right now her team is ahead, so she wants to kill this time a little bit. You can see that the Betties are racing a little bit. I mean, the longer you can keep the jam going when you're ahead, that's just less work you have to do in the long run.
Absolutely, yeah.
Looks like no points for either team.
So no points during that jam, and with 4.5 minutes to go, the Betties 227, Shoverkill game 107.
Yeah, we're definitely seeing the jammer rosters for both of these teams switching up quite a bit. They're still keeping their core jammers in there for the most part, but we're seeing some new faces, which is nice because some of those new faces are being really effective.
Absolutely, yeah. We've seen some folks that normally we think of as blockers put on the star and have great results.
Oh, we have Vermin Tacos.
Vermin Tacos.
Not delicious.
Mmm.
Vermin shoving against that sugar cube.
Beautiful defense yet again.
Tacos trying to get through the
both jammers facing some tough wall. Vermin trims it down to a 2-wall, gets through, and she's your lead jammer. On the other side, Sharon Tacos finally gets through on the outside, and she's looking for points.
The Betties have definitely been dominating lead jammer for this half. The first half, it was fairly close. There was maybe like a 3 jam difference, and let's see what we have here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10, 11. We've had 17 jams, and the Shotgun Betties, by my count, have had lead for 12 of them. So that makes a huge difference, and you can see the point spread is a lot wider in this second half than it was last time.
That is a telling stat, and you know, things were close in the first half with that big wide margin here in the second half. And also, like you were talking about with helping out your jammer and saving their energy, I think all of that work that they've done is starting to pay off here in the last half of the second 30 minutes. Coco Rola Diva is out there as lead jammer for the Shoverkill gang.
That is the first lead they have had in 4 jams, so good on Coco Rola Diva.
Boo Boo Bradley fights off. Shred Mosley is the last line of defense, so both jammers eligible for points. Coco hits the pack, gets bumped off, taps the hips after tallying 1 point for the Shoverkill gang.
I remember when I was a blocker, every now and then I'd get put into jam, and if I did well, they kept putting me into jam, and I was like, oh, man.
after it's like, damned if you do, damned if you don't.
I'm not built for this.
Like, I want to give it my all, but I don't really want to succeed.
I want to have something left of me to scrape off the floor and take home. Oh, is that Shadow Cat up there jamming
indeed
for the first
it
time?
Is. Yeah.
This should be interesting. I love watching the really, really amazing blockers jam because they leave a lot of bodies in their wake usually when they get up through the pack.
Sharon Taco is wearing the star for the Sugar Kill Gang. She somehow muscles her way through, and she's lead jammer, but hot on the trail is Shadow Cat.
Shadow Cat in first move.
Yeah. See, and that was great. Shadow Cat got Tacos to call it off. No.
Coming upon the last minute when the whistle blows, what could be our final jam, 231 to 108 in favor of the Shotgun Bettys. Luna Shovegood versus Fallen Angel.
Fallen Angel taking the star for the Sugar Kill Gang and for the Shotgun.
You know, earlier this season, it was one of those cases where I would kind of act halfway surprised if there was some action at the pivot line, but you know, we're seeing it so much, it's become part of the game this season much more regularly.
I think they just got bored. We have a lead jammer that is going to be Fallen Angel.
That's the third lead call in a row for the Sugar Kill Gang.
Ooh, Fallen Angel goes up the insides, jumps over a body to get there. 5 points.
5 points. In the meantime, Luna Shovegood has been bumped off twice already on the outside. Had to recycle back. Shred Mosby is holding her on the backstretch.
Shred Mosby just does not want to let her go. Not at all.
Fallen Angel, though, hits the pack one more time. She taps the hips. Looks like 4 points are going to go up there for the Sugar Kill Gang. They are going to call a timeout with 8 seconds left. Your score, 232 to 117 in favor of the Shotgun Bettys. Folks, once again, we want to thank you for joining us here at coloradosports.tv and also remind you that towards the bottom of the screen, you should see a button that says donate. Nobody gets paid for everything that we're doing here, and coloradosports.tv is no exception. Please click that donate button, see if you can spare a couple bucks and keep this thing going so you can watch all of the roller derby action going on in the state from your home, your office, your telephone, check that, your cell phone, your iPad, whatever. If you can't make it to the venue, at least make it to coloradosports.tv.
All right, so our final jammer matchup is going to be Cocorola Diva for the Sugar Kill Gang versus Grace Riot for the Shotgun Bettys.
No penalties rolled over from our timeout, so it's 5-on-5.
That means we make it loud enough to shake the roof in here.
Can we get louder than the thunder outside?
I think we can make it louder than the thunder.
Looks like Cocorola Diva may have been trying to draft on Grace Ride, and it looks like it actually worked. She is coming up around the outside. Oh, hit to the outside. Someone got a cut. Oh, it looks like Cocorola Diva is going to be going to the penalty box. Grace Riot is the
lead.
Grace Riot, lead jammer. The game clock is done, so we're looking at the jam clock. It's at 1.5 minutes. Grace Riot can call it off at any point in time and put the finishing touches on this one for the Bettys.
5 points for Grace Riot. Grace is like looking at her bench like, should I call it? And they're probably looking back like, I don't care. Do what you want. It's cool. Whatever.
I guess I'll just score some more points.
Score. It's cool. I'm here. I may as well.
Yeah,
it's
I fine. Came all this way.
Grace Riot has just a fantastic instinct for holes, too. You can just almost see her eyes darting around, and she, like, changes her mind in a millisecond.
Yeah, indeed. She doesn't need a lot of space and then just makes the most of every little inch she gets out there.
Looks like our unofficial final is going to be 117 points for the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls Sugar Kill Gang versus 242 points for the Denver Roller Girls Shotgun Bettys. And that is the final.
That is now an official final, so Shotgun Bettys, they took advantage of some penalties early on in the first half and then just came out in the second half and instilled their will, did anything they wanted to offensively, defensively, and really rolled it up on the Sugar Kill Gang.
Mm-hmm. Well, plus by the second half, you're warm, you know, you're warmed up,
yeah.
Rehydrate a little bit, have a few snacks, listen to some good tunes.
And congratulate them.
Well, thank you again for tuning in, ladies and gentlemen. It's been a pleasure. Again, I'm Postal Cervix.
I am Mr. Glitter.
And tune in next time.